welcome you to the April 17th meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. And before we begin, I would like Commissioner Byrd, if you would do our invocation.
Thank you, Eddie. In recognition of the wide diversity of faiths and that we have in our community, I would like to offer a moment of silence so that each of us can pray in our own way. And as we do, I'd like to ask that we please remember why we are here, so that this body can lead and govern our county government as a body and not as individuals in a manner that is best for all of our citizens. And having just returned from a national conference on family justice centers, I'd like for us to remember the victims and survivors of human trafficking, domestic violence, and sexual assault, and those that are suffering from other forms of oppression and enslavement, abuse, crime, and social injustices. And let's remember, please, those that are homeless and hungry, especially our children, and those that are suffering from mental and physical illnesses and the challenges of aging. And let's remember our first responders, our law enforcement officers, and our uniformed armed services personnel who put themselves in harm's way every day to protect us. So with these things in mind, let's have a moment of silence. Thank you.
I apologize, folks. I thought I had it turned off. We're good. All right. First thing, we have public speakers, and we have a number of folks that want to speak, and we're going to just do all of our public speaking in the beginning of the meeting. Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. Jump the gun.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Pardon me. Got in a hurry there, didn't I? Okay, public speakers. Just want to remind everyone we have 3 minutes on our schedule for each one. And first one speaking tonight is Andrea Chase.
A commitment to world-class education to encourage a prosperous community and individual success for all, from cradle to grave. And I do emphasize all on purpose. Within Alamance Burlington School System Strategic Plan, their vision adopted in June 2013, their statement asserts, "We envision a public school system that is a national model for its curriculum and community engagement, to empower all Alamance community students with equal opportunity for civic engagement, a meaningful quality of life, and skills for economic success for them and our community." If you put both of those strategic plans side by side together, we have a lot more similarities than differences. So I feel like now is the time for these two governing bodies to come together and really work to make our county great, and for it to be known across the state, and Alamance Burlington School System says even nationwide as a model for other people to look through. But with that, there's words, but there's actions and things that have to be done. And that also means there are bills to be paid. And you have to pay your dues whenever you're going to become an exemplary institution of any variety. So I am asking for the citizens of Alamance County to consider that, for us to move forward and to be known as an exemplary school system, a place people want to live, a place where people want to move and bring their children and be in the public schools, go on to the community college, to go on to our great institutions such as UNC Chapel Hill, Duke, High Point, Elon, wherever they take them, so that they're better prepared to go on and be successful students. And hopefully with Alamance County being at that brink and going forward into the 21st century, they will want to stay here. They won't want to move away to the big cities, and they will want to stay and be part of Alamance County in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next we have Sean Ewing.
Honorable Commissioners, I'm here to speak tonight in strong support of the Alamance-Burlington school system. As third vice chair of the Alamance County Democratic Party, we strongly support the ABSS budget. I'm also here for personal reasons. I'm proud to live in Alamance County, and the fiance and I would like to have kids here. However, we want them to be taught here also. We want them to have the best education possible. We need to see improvements in the school system, and those improvements will start with y'all. Speaking with community members and visiting local schools, we see dire need for improvement. And you know what? We're not alone. We've spoken to many, many constituents. This issue is nonpartisan because those parents, regardless of their political registration and voting history, want a better school for their children. This budget will be about the future of Alamance County. For quick example, a local high school band is doing everything within its power to get more funding for the band. At a recent VFW meeting, a local high school band was requesting a fundraiser be held at the VFW facility. In fact, the VFW commander attended one of the band's events because the commander also mentored the band members in Boy Scouts. The commander said that the local band was on par, if not better, than any of the other bands at the event. The only thing that the local high school visibly lacked against the other high schools was additional funds. This is just one example of what we're hearing in the community. I ask you, commissioners, please approve the Burlington school system budget. It's time for us to be bold. I ask the commissioners to be bold and be the leaders we need in the current and future children for the current and future children of Alamance County. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. All right, Joe Tickle.
For you tonight to remember the old folks when you raise the taxes, because there's poor people and old people in this county that can't pay their taxes now, and they don't need a raise. They do without things right now paying their taxes, so you won't take the property away from them. And if you belong to an organization that you're going to be giving tax money, and you need to recuse yourself. Stay out of it. You don't have no business giving our tax money to some organization that you're on the board of or you're a trustee. Thank you.
Tony Cox.
We keep hearing the same thing over and over and over again. We need more money, but we're failing. Give more money, still failing. I've been told that when that's going on, then what else is going to work? Maybe it's time for sanctions. Sanctions work. I think it's the newspaper today says, don't put the politics into the sporting events. When they jumped on the people on the bathroom bill, the people started stepping up and saying, hey, we'll hold you accountable, and it got fixed. Well, maybe. People still hate gays, I guess. I don't. I love them. I love all Americans. But today, after 9 months of negotiation, strong negotiation, I settled a deal. It took 5 minutes. Ain't no telling how many thousands of dollars it took to settle it. But hey, it was what it was. 5 minutes to settle it. I encourage you to settle this deal with me. But if you don't want to, hey, it is what it is. But I'm hopeful because, you know, I want to go somewhere to where it ain't hopes and promises. There are people that are doing. And I've been all up and down the East Coast and other places, and I see it. I see people doing better. They're not just promising, they're doing it. United Airlines has shown us a big deal in the last week. People are sick and tired of people coming in as thugs and just beating them down because they think they can. Either whether, I don't care if it's a lawman. I seen down in Lake County, Florida this morning, flipping channels on the TV, a sheriff down there talking about going after drug dealers, busting into their house in the middle of the night, and the four guys behind him, hey, they look like ISIS fighters to me. But hey, you know, police make mistakes too. They busted in wrong doors. We got examples of it right here. Y'all have to be the check and balance. Y'all said y'all wanted to be the check and balance for this county. Be the check and balance for this county. But y'all need to get y'all's together too. I go to the city of Burlington last week, and I watched that council down there go against the fire chief over there, letting people put houses after the setbacks was done, maybe 15 feet. Why do you want to put a fireman in between two burning buildings that close together?
All right, Mike Holland.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm Dr. Mike Holland, Director of Ceres in Saxapaha. In 2012, Saxapaha was selected by a California amusement park developer for Whirly Woods, yet the site was not publicly announced until last month. First, please let me state that Ceres supports new clean tax dollars in Alamance County. Our evaluation team assessed their project. It feels the potential for dramatic impact to our county is sufficient to encourage your commission to ask these good folks to present you their plans in person. They welcome the opportunity, and Ceres supports placing their plans in the public record. There are over 75 signers to a petition, and I've got four more tonight sitting here, who feel that Saxapaha is not only the right is not the right location for a large, loud, lit amusement park, and would snarl traffic. But until last week, when I met privately with the three principals for an hour, we had no specifics. They shared the following in that meeting: 10,000 visitors per day within 10 years, phase one opening in 2 years, crowd size control through reservations, it would be open Easter to Halloween, 10 to 6. They'll have overnight in-park sleeping quarters for 50. They'll not be growing beyond the 21 acres, they say. And they bought the land knowing it would not percolate for septic work. We know the following concerns our county: parking, thousands of daily visitors from the Triad and the Triangle, conforming to our 2020 and Park and Rec's master plans, and assessing noise and light pollution in a 2 mile radius. Finally, we've just learned that the Hog River Keeper has moved from Bynum to Saxapaha, as has the headquarters of the Hog River Assembly, which I thought you should know. Their director has concerns, quote, about the effects of the park and what they would have on water quality, particularly Mary's Creek, Haw River tributary. She mentioned impacts from construction sediment, stormwater runoff, and sewage effluent. She said, quote, "We look forward to future opportunities for public input. Although the developers want family-friendly Enviro Park, our committee expressed concern over unintended future consequences, including other developers snapping up adjacent parcels, leading to urban sprawl, future owners expanding size and hours, dramatically increasing noise, light, and traffic, investors demanding a larger park to fast-track their return on investment. And regarding size, there are thousands of acres that are around there that are available, 600 available adjacent acres. With county oversight and the developers' self-censure, it may be possible to contain these threats and maximize this clean tax-based opportunity. We look forward to hearing the results of your meeting with the Whirlywoods team." Thank you, and I'll be glad to handle any questions.
Just leave those petitions with Tori, if you will.
We've got them outside.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right. Next, Tamara Kersey.
Good evening. My name is Tamara Kersey. Thank you for this opportunity. I am a resident of Graham. I am the pastor of Maxwell Chapel, and I am on the committee with Dr. Mike Holland that is exploring the building of the Whirligig Park. This park is less than a mile from where the church is. The church is also in a community where we have, one of my members are here. They've been established in that neighborhood for 75 to 100 years, and you're asking to relocate people who have established homes there. You're asking seniors to up and relocate. You're looking at land that cannot be perked. You're looking at roadways that are not, don't have the capacity for the amount of traffic that this particular amusement park will bring on into the community. So I'm simply asking that when they present the plans to you with their budget, that you evaluate, is the Saxophone Hall, Lower South, Southern Alamance area, the best place for the amusement park? Just evaluate it and think about the members. Think about the adults who are senior citizens. Think about the children who will not have yards that have moved into the county to have the experience of the Saxophone Hall community. Thank you for your time, and God bless you.
Thank you. Amanda Baker.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm sorry, I actually am one of the residents downstream from the Whirligig Park, where it's planned to be developed, so I wish to address that tonight. My family has lived in Eli Whitney for nearly 50 years, not as long as some, but certainly long enough. I was born here, I moved away for college, discovered city life in DC, and found that it really wasn't for me. I realized that I missed the quiet mornings on our farm, working with our animals, the fresh air, and frankly, I miss seeing the Milky Way at night. Everything that makes rural life as difficult as it can be, my home and my piece of paradise. I have returned to a community that has progressed from the devastation of a tornado that we thought would kill Saxophaw, to farmers fighting for the very heart of the dairy community through the financial crisis like Randy Lewis, to the Haw River finally clean, now hosting kayakers and the Haw River Trail. Our community has risen like a phoenix through sustainable, environmentally conscious development that has adapted to what already exists. Businesses that directly support our Southern Alamance economy of farmers, brewers, bakers, canners, and makers. We lost Martha's Restaurant. We gained Reference Farms Cafe and a farm through it. We lost Donald Davis's Exxon station. And just last week, we got the Davis Pub and Grill. We are growing, but it is in a way that supports the best of everything that we are. For the first time in my life, I find a threat to my community and directly to my family farm. We are directly downstream from the development by not even a mile. As an environmental studies major with a background in watershed health testing downstream from manicured lawns and golf courses, I feel that our environment will be heavily affected with no recourse. Our and our neighbors' farms run on well water, something free and sacred to our community and our independence. Will the county force us onto city water when ours is no longer potable because of everything dumped into the stream? I remember when they put in the new ball field lights up at Eli Whitney, and I lost a third of our night sky to light pollution. I can't imagine what it would look like with a roller coaster amusement park at the other end. Sorry. I can already hear more traffic on 87 as it is. The thought of more is frightening when I hear of neighbors' cows getting out. Never mind the screams of out-of-towners on roller coasters, or the crime brought by people that think we are easy pickings because many people I know still don't lock their doors. I worry we will be priced out of our way of living by taxes brought on by its presence. I ask you to consider another home for this park, not Southern Alamance. This is something that would has the potential to completely destroy our way of, rural way of life in my home. There are better equipped places in this county for this project. Thank you.
Guy Sinclair.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
Before I get into my prepared remarks, I heard reference to a world-class school system here in Alamance County. I will say that the superintendent is sure being paid a world-class salary, it looks like. But anyway, on to my prepared remarks. My name is Guy Sinclair. I live within walking distance of the courthouse here. I live right up here on North Main Street in Graham. I have a 53-year-old daughter and a 56-year-old son-in-law and four grandchildren who live in Madison, Wisconsin. These four grandchildren are between the ages of 16 and 12. The middle two grandchildren are twins. My daughter is a stay-at-home mom, thus this family of six is a one-income family. Every other year, they visit us here, my wife and I, in Alamance County, and they use discount airline tickets to get here. In addition to visiting with my wife and me, they visit other relatives and friends and family here. My daughter is a graduate of Southern Alamance High School. A year ago, when they visited, they rented a six-passenger van, and the six of them drove to Washington, D.C. This was so that my four grandchildren could become acquainted with our nation's capital. They did the tourist bit. They visited the Washington Monument, the Jefferson Memorial, the capital of the Smithsonian, and all the other educational sites. This year, they plan to fly here this coming summer, and while here again, they hope to rent another six-passenger van. They'd like to drive to Atlanta. They want to see a Braves game. They want to visit the Coca-Cola Center, the Georgia Aquarium, and then they want to drive to Athens, Georgia, home of the University of Georgia. My son-in-law and my daughter are both University of Georgia graduates, and they would like their four kids to see the campus there. So my question to you folks is, especially you three who recently voted to add to the already high tax burden suffered by rental car and van users, why should this Wisconsin family be required to subsidize Guilford County residents and other local folks who ride a park bus to Chapel Hill? Why shouldn't park riders pay the actual cost of ridership? Why do any of you three think park riders shouldn't pay their own way? Thank you.
Dorothy Yarber.
Good evening, Commissioners, and thank you for hearing us this evening. And I want to speak briefly about the budget for the Alamance Burlington School System. In reading the mission of the Alamance Burlington School System, it is very important. It says, providing engaging work for every student will enable the Alamance Burlington School System to educate all students to meet high academic standards and become responsible citizens in a rapidly changing world. And you know, it was interesting enough to read about each of you, because as I read, each of you addressed education as part of your platform. So thank you so very much for doing that. You also talked about the inadequacies of education in Alamance County, but you also talked about the importance of education in Alamance County. Now, you also adopted a vision statement which says Vision Alamance, and then of course we have the five pillars. One of the pillars says world-class education, and you know that one pillar drives the other four pillars that we adopted. And that is including preserving agriculture, smart growth and development, public health and safety, government accountability and resource management. Without education, without adequate education, we won't have any of that. But in order to have world-class education, we here at the Alamance Burlington school system, we have to reach the level of adequate, effective, and efficient education first, before we can even become world class. Without it, we will have a lack of committed teachers. There will be a lack of a learning environment, a lack of competitive student and leaders, and a lack of any chance of growth and development. While we are waiting, the world is not waiting on us. Thank you.
All right, next, Mr. Don Cox.
My name is Don Cox, and I operate an automobile dealership here in Burlington, Cox Toyota. Our family's been in the car business here in Burlington since 1945. We love the community, but I'm here on a matter that I don't think is fair. Last week, you folks decided to put the burden of the deficiency in rental fees on the backs of those people who rent cars. I appreciate the remarks of this gentleman over here who appeared earlier about his family from Wisconsin coming down and bearing part of this burden. I think we should ask ourselves, first of all, is this park bus system, is it a charity? I don't think so. Is it a business? It's a business, and it's partly a service as well. Why should people who work at the UNC Hospital in Chapel Hill pay $3 to go to work and back every day? Or is it four? I don't know. But you know, you think about it, some of the best automobiles in gasoline mileage could get, let's say, 20 miles to the gallon. And 60 miles round trip to Chapel Hill is about 3 gallons. And with gasoline at $2.50, you're looking at $7.50 there, to say nothing of the cost of a place to park. And so I would ask the bus system to consider charging a reasonable fare. Either that, or if it's a charity, we can put it on the United Way, and we can all chip in to support it. But anyway, I just don't think it's fair that a tax should be levied on a small group of people in our community. I think a tax should be spread out as broadly as possible, and should it be a tax or should it be a charity? That's it.
Thank you. All right, Commissioner responses. Anybody got a response?
I'd like to remind Mr. Cox that vote was 3-2.
Okay.
Well, I certainly agree with you.
I would like to comment on Mr. Holland's remarks and about the that amusement park coming before this board. I don't know that we have jurisdiction. Maybe I guess we do, from the standpoint of regulating wastewater and waste.
Zoning wise, we don't.
Waste, pardon?
We don't have it zoning.
We don't have countywide zoning, but if somebody's going to have maybe it's not wastewater but sewage type of waste, then have a sewer system, and the land doesn't perk, then that's going to have to come to our planning board.
Stopped at the health department. They'll have to go to the health department on that.
So I'm wondering if there's not a better, to start with, for them to attend a planning board meeting or the Board of Health or...
I'm going to ask Libby, have they attended your board meeting or have they brought you any preliminaries?
We haven't seen any plans, sir. And we don't have any regulations, any development regulations that would necessarily apply.
But they would have to have the septic permitting enough to carry the park.
According to state law, and that's put in force by our health. They would just apply and it would either be approved or not approved. I'm unsure of whether they have any sort of variance ability or anything like that that would come to the public body. I've never seen one.
Could we get a plat of the location of that? I've been contacted. I don't have the slightest idea where it's going. I'd like to see a plat of the where they propose to build it.
Moore's Chapel.
Yeah,
I'd like to see a plat of that. I'd like
to
see a map.
You want me to email it to you?
I don't care how I get it. I just like to see it.
Okay.
Send him the parcel number. He's got a computer now. He's good. You got a computer, you can pull it up with a parcel number. Yeah.
I just want to see it.
Okay. All right.
I have a little comment.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, for Mr. Sinclair, he raised an interesting point about why should travelers pay taxes in other places? And that is an interesting question. I just thought about, we have an occupancy tax that people pay in hotels. People who stay here pay an occupancy tax. We're going to talk about that tonight, or I'm not sure if it's tonight or the next budget meeting, what happens with the occupancy tax, but that goes by statute to support local tourism. And we also, the people who stop and eat their meals on the interstate, if they go to the Cracker Barrel or other establishments, they have to pay taxes for the food that they eat while they're here. And those sales taxes support things in North Carolina and our school system. So just because somebody comes from another area and has to pay a tax, I'm not sure that that's necessarily unfair. I would be interested to know more about the cost of the rental van and how much really it's costing them out of their pocket. That would be interesting information to me to know. And I wish that we had known things like that before we had our vote. I also wanted to mention for Mr. Cox, he's talking about how cheap it is to pay $3 to go back and forth to work, for people to go back and forth to work every day. So that's $6 round trip. And I remember I was at the Burlington Municipal Building when the PART group had their public hearing, and Mr. Cox spoke there, and also one of his workers spoke there. And please correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that your manager said that y'all charge $35 to $40 to rent your cars. So a 5% tax on $40 is $2. And so on one way, you're talking about how cheap it is for people to ride the bus for $3, but then that's still more than your customers are paying. And there was another interesting aspect that was raised, in that the other jurisdictions around Alamance County are already paying this tax. It's paid in Guilford County, Orange County, whoo, they pay a lot of taxes to support their bus system, bless their hearts. So I just thought that those were appropriate responses to the interesting comments that you gentlemen raised. So thank you for coming tonight.
Very good.
Can we respond at all?
No, sir. All right, I'd like to ask for the approval of the agenda. Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, the consent agenda. Do we have anything on there? I don't think there's not a whole lot there to look at, so. Do we need to pull anything? If not.
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Presentations tonight. I'm going to start out, and we have a proclamation. This is Week of the Young Child coming up, and I would like Carrie Field to come forward, if she would.
Good evening, Commissioners. professionals who make a difference in the lives of young children in Alamance County deserve thanks and recognition. Public policies that support early learning for all young children are crucial to the young children's futures, and now there it be resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim April 24th through the 28th, 2017, as the week of a young child in Alamance County, North Carolina, and encourage all citizens to work to make a good investment in early childhood. Carrie, would you like to make some comments?
Certainly. We are absolutely thrilled, the Alamance Partnership for Children, the staff and the board, to have this proclamation. It's so important that we bring more awareness to early childhood in Alamance County. I've heard lots of comments tonight about our education system, and I know a lot of folks here know that unless we build that foundation with our youngest children and the families of those children, we can't have a high-class, world-class education system. So this means a lot to us, and I appreciate the commissioners recognizing next week is the week of the young child. We will be celebrating with a early childhood summit. Please check out our website, alamancechildren.org. Everyone is invited. We would love to see folks here come out.
Thank you very much
for your work.
All right. Next, Brian. Hey, Brian. Get the Brian's mixed up here in a minute. Brian Baker, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners. I have two items for you tonight. The first is approval to apply a grant from the North Carolina Parks and Recreation Trust Fund. The grant would seek funding to allow us to acquire some additional property for the Hall River Trail. This is the third grant that we have applied of this sort over the years. The first connected the Glencoe community to Red Slide Park in downtown Hall River. That trail opened this past year. The second grant allowed some acquisition of property between Swepsonville and Saxbaugh, and we are in the construction phase of that section. And this grant would allow us some funds to acquire property in northern Alamance County in the Altamaha area. There's no particular property identified at this point. We will negotiate those with individual landowners once the funds are approved. But this is some funds from the state to acquire that property. There are no county funds required.
There's no match.
Does that connect to Guilford County on the northeast side?
Yes, this section will start at the Guilford County line, right, and go downriver. And Guilford doesn't have their section completed yet, but one day we'll connect with Northeast Park and along the river up to Hall River State Park.
You know, Northeast Park's about to go under in Guilford. It's having a rough time. Well, at least the train is. I don't have a train. It didn't do well.
We don't have any trains.
Yeah. No trains. No trains. Any other questions, comments? I'll entertain a motion for Brian to apply for this.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, I'll second.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Hearing no opposition? Move forward, sir.
Great. The second item is approval of the addendum to our recreation master plan. Our original plan was done in 2007, and it was intended to last us through 2020. Our department has undergone quite a bit of change in the past 10 years, and so it was time for a brief update. It's not an entirely new report, but it just kind of updates where we've come as a department and what our immediate priorities are for the next few years. Since that was completed, brag on our department a little bit. We've completed a joint use agreement with the school system. We have completed the Hall River Paddle Trail, and we've added 17.5 miles of trail to the Hall River Land Trail. And we've also acquired some additional property at Cedar Rock Park, all of which were called for in the master plan. So it's been a useful document for us, and we've accomplished a lot of the things in that document. In updating it, we took a lot of the input that we received through the Vision Alamance strategic plan process and integrated that into our plan. We also did a new rec needs survey, a survey of the county to see what they wanted us to be working on. We got a great response, about 1,500 survey responses to that to give us some direction. Just for interest, the number one thing they wanted was us to develop trails and greenways. Number two was to improve and maintain our existing parks, and number three was to create new parks. Those are all pretty in line with our mission. So we can do those things. This plan should last us hopefully another 5 to 10 years. There's nothing new that you guys don't know about in there. The primary things we need to be working on in the immediate future are the development of Saxbaugh Island, the development of Cane Creek Mountain Natural Area, and continued development of the Harbor Trail. So if you have any questions about the update, I'd be happy to answer.
I read through the plan, not every word, but it was very thorough.
Yes.
And what I really liked about it is that using the input from the forums that we had from our strategic planning process, and how consistent it is with that pillar of plan growth.
Those were helpful. The one question about where do you see us in our county in 30 years was one question that we asked at all the forums, and I think we counted 24-25% of the responses to that question were regarding Parks and Rec and the things that we do. So it was very helpful to get that.
So this is all part of quality of life here in Alamance County, which helps attract new residents and businesses and helps with economic growth and, you know, so I support it.
I guess we need to vote on it, then, don't we?
I'll make the motion. We support it.
Thank you, Bill.
I'll second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. You made that long presentation short.
I think the people in the back are having trouble hearing. Maybe we can get the microphone
raised. Can everybody hear in the back?
No.
Okay. Have we got a volume control master of speakers?
Is there a mic stand where the microphone could be closer to the speakers? That might help.
Sorry, I'm new. Scott, do you have any suggestions?
The only suggestion for that wireless mic is if they picked it up and spoke into it like Max did.
Is it just the wireless mic that's a problem, or is everybody having problems hearing everybody?
Everybody.
We can move on.
Bring our mics up closer. That helps. All right. Next on our agenda, we have a resolution approving the sale of property on Turrentine Street. And I'm going to ask our county attorney if you want me to read it, or you want to come and talk to him a little bit for us.
Let him talk. He's good to talk.
I know. He looks like he's about to get
Thanks a lot.
My mic seems to be working well.
It is. Very well.
Anyway, what you have before you is an offer from a gentleman here in Alamance County to purchase that 1.25-acre parcel. It's the parcel of land between the Lifespan Services and Ralph Scott Services. It was left when we sold those two parcels in 2014. And I understand you may have some questions about it. You may want to postpone discussing it, but this is one method of bringing that before you for your consideration, and we can postpone it till our next meeting and develop some more questions, answers to your questions.
I did have a.
It's working now.
I did have a lot of questions about this based on the information that was in the packet. When I put in the tax parcel number that was in the information, the notice of sale of the property, and other documents, it came up with a property on the GIS that had a value of $990,000, and on the GIS it hadn't been subdivided. So from looking at the information in the agenda, it had the appearance that we were thinking about selling a $990,000 property for $38,500, which led me to have a lot of questions. And we communicated by email, but I think that in the public's interest, it would be good if we had the time to really go through those questions thoroughly and really vet the offer.
Those two properties, the board decided to convey to the nonprofits. They were in ill repair, needed new roof, air conditioning system, those type of things. This little tract of land's on a hill, and it's chain-linked, fenced in, and we spend about $600 mowing it every year. the outfit that has made an offer, and it is just an offer. The board can consider it. You can put it out for public bid. You can ask the person to raise his offer, and you can reject it outright. But the way the statute works, if you put it out there for bid, then if it really is more valuable than his offer, someone will upset the bid, much like we do on our foreclosure sales. And if not, you can ask for an appraisal of the property. The idea with the statute is by putting out for public bid, you can save that cost, because if it is really a desirable piece of property, more people will bid on it.
I think that the questions that I would have would probably take a good bit of time. I would make a motion to table this agenda item
tonight. I'll second that.
Okay. All right. If everybody's okay with that, I don't know that we really need a vote on that, but we've got motion and a second, so we will vote.
We don't need to sell property that's worth more than they're willing to pay.
Okay. I got a motion and a second. All in favor of tabling this to a later date?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Thank
I'd like
you,
to see photographs of this. I mean, you know, amazing. You know, I haven't seen photographs of it. I'd like to see
it. All right. We can get this.
I mean, how much acreage is it?
1.25 acres.
Maybe a case where the land's more important, more in value than the house.
Sounds like it is.
But I'd like to see the photographs.
There's no house on it.
It's a vacant lot. It's a vacant lot between the two.
So there's no building?
No. Mm-hmm. All right.
We'll do an aerial photograph.
Next on our agenda tonight, we have a resolution supporting the North Carolina General Statute 115C-301, which is a return of class size adjustments to local school boards. And I will be glad to read that if you, or we can just look at it. If anybody got a question on it, we're just asking the General Assembly basically to give a little more local jurisdiction to the local school boards about class size. Do you have any questions, anyone? Or?
Well, we do have several members of the school board.
I was going to recognize them when we get into session of the thing, and let Dr. Harrison know they're standing out there behind him. okay, well, this resolution is just will be passed on to the General Assembly. I would like a motion on it if everybody's in agreement with this.
I so move.
All right, thank you, Bob.
A second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, very good. All right. And these resolutions, we never know how they may end up. We've sent a few down, so. But it's like an ask. That's what we're doing. next on our agenda is adjustment to the amendment to the rules and procedure of the Board of Commissioners. And it seemed at our last meeting there was a consensus of the board that we just put all public comments back to the first. So if that be the case, then let's just vote it and be done with it.
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
Okay.
You need a motion?
Yeah.
So moves.
All right.
I'll second.
Thank you, Bob.
People don't need to wait to the end of the meeting to talk.
Okay, we're good. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Anyone in opposition? There are none. All right. Now, Dr. Harrison, I think you're next up. And before he starts, I would like to have him recognize his school board members here. I can't see all of them. They're kind of scattered about.
Run the rest of the Ms. Patsy Simpson, Pam Thompson, Steve Van Pelt, our
I would have missed him.
Howie Gant, our vice chair, Cody Rhodes, Brian Peters, and Mark Bay.
Very good. Thank y'all for being with us tonight.
Mr. Chair, Commissioners, I appreciate the opportunity to spend a little bit of time with you going through our budget request. I believe County Manager or Finance Officer sent you some materials recently that include our vision, includes our the strategic plan progress, see what type of growth we've been making, and includes our proposed budget. I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about the progress that we've made as a result of the investment that you've made in public education over the past 2 years. Too often we look at funding for education as an expense. I prefer to see that as an investment. I don't think there is any greater return on investment than investing in our young people. I will say I appreciate the adoption of that resolution. General Assembly has been hitting us pretty hard and taking away flexibility, and that will create some difficulties if that bill and multi-year bill does not pass. And our board this morning, actually this afternoon, passed the resolution that you requested that we consider concerning the return of lottery funding to the original formula. I believe we formerly received about $2.5 million per year. This year we're getting somewhere in the neighborhood of $1.5 million. When I came to this board in 2014 and asked for a significant increase in our budget, we built that budget around the strategic plan. And we wanted to determine what would it take to fully implement that strategic plan over a 5 to 8 year period of time. And the figure is a big one. It was about $24 million. In the past 2 years, we've chipped away at that. You've chipped away at that, and we're appreciative of that. And we put, to date, about $6.5 million, no, about $3.5 million towards that. Still have a long ways to go, but I think I'll be able to share with you that we have produced a return on that investment that you're making. The community came together, and you've heard reference to this by a couple of speakers, and you've received this, adopted this vision for public education in 2013. The staff of ABSS, before I arrived, developed a wonderful strategic plan, and the Board of Education was very clear to me when they hired me in July of 2014 that my primary responsibility was putting some traction on that strategic plan. And we've been very, very intentional about everything that we do, everything that we ask for, that we tie it back to this strategic plan, which is tied directly to this vision. And one of the things that this vision shares for our local leaders, we expect to hold accountable the Board of Education, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, the Alamance Burlington School System for the development and implementation of a strategic plan resulting in this vision becoming a reality. And again, I believe that if we can follow through and continue the progress that we're making with regards to our strategic plan, in fairly short order, this vision will become a reality. And you've heard me talk about it many times, and I'd like to just take this with you and take a look at it. I'm not going to read all the statements that you've heard tonight and that you've heard me say before that you most likely read. But we want our students to learn in a safe, modern facility with exceptional teachers. Curriculum that can be a national model for core academic subjects, arts, communication, critical thinking, and social skill development. We have three basic priorities. And again, this was not adopted by Bill Harrison, it was not adopted by the staff, it was not adopted by the board. It was developed by a large group of community members. Priority number one, school equity and consistency. We want every child, regardless of where he or she lives in Alamance County, to have a first-class education. We don't want the zip code of a child to determine the quality of his or her education. Every youngster that we have deserves the very best we have. Every youngster deserves for us to provide him or her with the type of life opportunities we would want our own children to have. Priority two, recruiting and retaining high quality staff. At the end of the day, it comes down to competent, caring teachers working with nationals. Competent, caring teachers go to schools where we have strong personal leadership. So we think that is absolutely, at the end of the day, so much has changed. The classroom looks remarkably different than the classroom that I attended. But the role of the functioning teacher is still key. And priority three with classroom and school support. We have these six goals. I'm going to address each of these goals very briefly and just point to some markers that demonstrate that this is truly becoming a we've heard earlier a couple of presentations about accountability, about progress, about growth. Exemplary classroom teachers, we personalize our professional development program. We see in our teacher working condition survey evidence that this is really meeting the needs of our teachers. And we received recognition by the North Carolina Association for Supervision of Curriculum Development for the quality of that program. Our Teacher Leadership Academy, which is funded by Impact Alamance, the Chambers, and Bob and that, was recently recognized at the National School Boards Association Annual Conference in Denver. We've changed our Principal Leadership Academy as a result of the experiences that we've had in the Teacher Leadership Academy. So our principals are once a month receiving some of those same opportunities. And we've implemented, which I think will be a model, we're actually in year three of our digital learning professional development in conjunction with the Friday Institute at North Carolina State University. Too many school systems across the state and across the nation have become enamored with putting digital devices in the hands of kids. And what happens is they put the devices in the hands of students before teachers are ready to use the devices the way they need to. So we're at a point now that we're very intentional about our teachers that end up having a one-to-one environment. Exemplary classroom teaching and instructional leadership, again, comes down to what happens for youngsters. The zero line represents a year's worth of growth for our students. The notion being that a student is entitled to 1 year's growth for 1 year's of education. So at that zero, the child is receiving that year's growth. And this is a composite. Anything above zero means they're getting more than 1 year growth. Year 2014, we were at a negative 1.36. That spring is when we had the increase in the budget, when investment in public education in Alamance County. So at the end of the 2015 year, we had 0.68. It's academic year 2014-2015. We had 0.68. This past year, we had a 1.38. I think that's fairly remarkable progress over a two-year period. And I've been around a long, long time. It typically takes 3 to 4 years for an organization, a school system, that is embarking on a strategic plan to really make traction and begin to move forward. And all the indicators that I'm seeing in our schools right now is this is going to be the real year. As well as we've done the last 2 years, I'm very optimistic about this year. This is ABSS school growth. In 2014, we had 12 of our schools did not meet growth. We only had 3 of our schools that exceeded growth. In 2016, we only had 4 schools that did not meet growth, and we have 13 that exceeded growth. Again, pretty remarkable improvement.
Could you define growth, please? It's not. It doesn't mean growing in student body.
No. This is academic achievement, academic growth. We can't do anything about where a child is when he or she comes to us. Some come to us without having had pre-K opportunities that they're very comfortable about. Some of them get to the fourth grade, not reading on fourth grade level. And what we can control is the movement that they make once they walk in that classroom. So if they start at point A, point B would be 1 year's growth. That's where we need to get them at the end of the year.
Thank you.
This is proficiency, the percentage of students that are at or above grade level. Again, nowhere near where we need it to be or where our students deserve to be. But again, we have in place, structures that are going to cause that to improve dramatically. Again, every measure that we use, if we look back to 2014, we did better in 2015, we did better in 2016, and I can assure you we'll do better in 2017. Master Plan for Specialized Program. Our early comments, thanks for a great partnership with ACC and Dr. Gakeman and his folks. Year one, we had 75 applicants. For the 2017-18 year, we have over 200 applicants. And we're looking at opening a pre-collegiate program at Graham High School to give those students who aren't pulled out of the lottery an opportunity. Our 6 global schools, we've gone from 3 schools having immersion programs to having 6 schools that have immersion programs and global programs. That's hosted visitors from all across the nation to see what those programs look like. Our Arts Plus program at Grade Plus program at North Grand has been a great success. I think some of you attended the Lion King that they had a couple of weeks ago. And they were recently recognized by the City Council in Grand. And CTEC just hosted some students from Switzerland, and we're having conversations about some of our students having an opportunity to visit. Switzerland in many years. Great deal of interest in the International Baccalaureate Program that we're looking at opening with Williams this coming year. Plans are in place at Columbus High School. We just today announced to the board that we received a $1.5 million Roman Leaf Foundation grant for, in conjunction with ACC, to develop a STEM program at Graham High School. Total is $2 million because $500,000 were donated in town. Again, but this is just another example of the spirit of collaboration that we needed to generate that match, and we went out and were able to get it in pretty short order. Fire Academy is the first phase of our Municipal Services Academy at Grand. Again, with the Chamber and ACC launched the Career Accelerator Program, and we continue to expand our virtual academy opportunities for students. 5-year facilities plan, we've been doing this a couple of times with you, I believe. Again, we have a long way to go. Our facilities have been neglected. We recognize that. The task force, the facility, Joint Facilities Task Force, has seen the plan that we have to take care of some deferred maintenance that wasn't dealt with. So it's going to take us a few years to catch up, but we feel that we're making progress. World-class teacher working conditions. We've had 3 cohorts of the ABSS Teacher Leadership Academy, Leadership Institute. We graduated 2 cohorts of the Teacher Leadership Academy. Our third cohort begins on Thursday. I think Brian will be with us out at the Saxapahaw. You'll hear about the vision, and our folks will. But every year we have 50 plus teachers involved in that. I've already talked about our professional development. The board has allowed us to have a half day professional development every once a month during the course of the year. And we've implemented what we call a digital badge program for educators, which allows them to participate in personalized professional development. And I think this is a real key when we look at world-class teacher working conditions. The number one reason teachers leave the profession is lack of administrative support, or they go somewhere else if they don't feel they're being supported. 2013-14, 15.5% of our teachers left us at the end of the year. 2014-15, 15.3% left us, and at the end of 2015-2016, 12.1% left us. That's a pretty significant decrease there, and it's the first time in anyone's memory that we did better than the state average with our teacher attrition. We don't think that's happened. We don't think anything has happened by accident. Things don't happen by accident. Good things don't happen by accident. Hard to read, but this are the teacher working conditions survey. The orange and red is 2016 is in the blue. The state does this every 2 years. Managing student conduct had an increase. They've all had increases. The one that you mentioned was professional development. Had one of our largest increases, and professional development is one that that school systems usually take a beating on because teachers see much of it as being irrelevant. So we think that demonstrates to us that what we're doing is creating those conditions where teachers want to be. And how I've kind of taken our vision and put it into my simplistic terms is that I want our schools to be places where kids want to be. I want students to get up every day and go to school, not because they have to, but because they want to. And I think if that is the case, then all that other stuff is going to take care of it. But we also want our schools to be places where adults want to work, that they don't want to go to Guilford County, they don't want to go to Durham, they don't want to go to Chapel, they want to come and work in Alamance. Compensation for building level employees, our goal over 5 years is to get on par with Orange and Durham and Guilford counties. You've given us a 1.5% increase over the past 2 years. We're asking for another percent this year. And we've done the same thing, same type of increase for our principals and our assistant principals. Classroom and school supports, we've added elementary art teachers to achieve equity at all of our elementary schools. Again, that resolution that you addressed today helps us retain that. We've had small increases to our instrumental music budget. We've increased our instructional supply budget. $7 per student doesn't sound like a lot, but 22,000 students, that's fairly significant. And we got about $250,000 last year from the Golden Leaf Foundation to support our one-to-one digital conversion. And again, just when children are educated by exceptional teachers using the best methods in great facilities with commensurate support and expectations from communities, families, expectations from families, community leaders, and the community at large, kids can attain incredible success. Public education is about providing all youngsters with access to their dreams. So that's the why. That's why I have some big numbers in front of you. It's not simply because I sit up and say, how can we spend money? It's because we sit and we look at that vision, we sit and we look at that strategic plan, we figure out what is it going to cost to make that a reality, and we try to be reasonable in how we can get there. Just as our student achievement isn't going to get where we want it to be overnight, we don't think we can get here overnight, fiscally. But I think if we truly believe in our kids, we'll make an investment in our kids. I believe we've been very transparent in the past 2 years. We've had conversations a couple of times with this board, with members of this board who are on the task force and talked about some things. And I will take 100% responsibility and accountability for everything that's gone on in ABSS since July 8, 2014. And we're looking forward. We're learning from the past. We still have a lot of learning to do. I'm sure you've looked through this. I'll just highlight from pages 12 to 15. And then I'll be happy to respond to any questions that you have, and I appreciate you indulging me. The first item, our present current expense funding was at $38 million. And pages 1 through 11 show you where we spent not only that $38 million, but the other 100 and...
I think the documents that we have don't have the same
page numbers. 247. We're not matching up on that.
It's page 247.
247, yes, sir.
Just a little while.
These aren't all my 247 pages. I only have 15.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, the 11 pages that precede that are... how the dollars are being spent this year. I think the percentages are very telling. 85% of our budget is people, salaries, and benefits. We don't have any big ticket programs out there. In 2014-2015, we cut about $2 million worth of programs as we moved some things around and as we became more aligned with all of our efforts. But what we're looking at this year, we are asking for nearly $1.5 million to cover inflationary expenses. The state retirement system is gonna cost us $44,000 more. The state health insurance is gonna cost us $236,000 more. We're looking at a 2% increase in utilities. It looks like, well, we calculated our supplement and our teacher raises using the figure of 2%. Have no idea where that's going to land. The governor's budget asked for a 5% increase. Don't think we're going to get to 5%, but we'll adjust if need be. We do have locally paid teachers, so to cover that is about $55,000. Excuse me. For the teachers, it's about $445,000. For the assistant principals and principals that are locally paid, it's $55,000. If House Bill 13 passes, we will need 10 additional teachers, which is about $540,000, and the growth in charter school enrollment, about $93,000. The second figure I have is what it will cost to increase the teacher supplement by 1%. We're looking at 1% a year for a 5 to 6 year period to get us on par with our neighbors. We did 1% year one, we did 0.5% last year. We originally looked at 1.5% this year to catch up, but we've scaled that back to 1%. Our supplements for our principals and assistant principals, again, you can see what the current supplement is, what the proposal is. about $67,000 for assistants, about $53,000 for principals. We have a classified pay scale that needs to be implemented. We've neglected our classified employees over the last 10 years. The state has neglected and continues to neglect, and I think roles and responsibilities have changed. We've looked at a number of other school systems, what they are doing to get our folks on a fair compensation scale. It's going to be just shy of $3 million. And again, on each of these requests, I do have what the strategic priority is. The teacher supplements is goal 5. Principal supplements, assistant principals are goal 5 as well. Is the certified classified pay scale is goal 5. The next page is continued growth of our master plan for specialized programs. I didn't mention it on the PowerPoint presentation, but we're planning to implement an A-plus program at Sylvan next year. We're growing in the Fire Academy. You see the Virtual Academy. Splash is our immersion program. Graham Collegiate is $250,000, if that makes, and we feel very confident that it will. STEAM program at a couple of our schools. Leader in Me is another one of our specialized programs at our elementary schools. That's built around the work of Stephen Covey. The next one is a custodian bus driver pilot. We've had a very, very difficult time recruiting and retaining bus drivers this year. We increased salaries last year. We've got an increase for bus driver salaries in our classified salary schedule. And we've also been contracting with our custodial services. That contract has one more year, and we've been thinking about taking our custodians back and letting them become ABSS employees again. So we've had a conversation with the group with whom we contract, asked them if we could take one attendance zone out of that contract, and we would hire our own custodian slash bus drivers. What this would look like, we determined the number of hours, number of man or woman hours, person hours, needed to keep the building at the in the condition that we want it to be kept in. Some of those custodians will be full-time custodians. Some of those custodians will be part-time custodians and part-time bus drivers. So I may start my day at 6 o'clock in the morning, drive a bus for 2.5 hours, and then for 5.5 hours, I'd work as a custodian. That way I get benefits. We think that part of the problem with the bus drivers is they just have very unusual work schedule, that they work a couple hours in the morning, a couple hours in the afternoon, don't have anything in the afternoon, during the middle of the day, and they don't receive benefits. So we think that this is going to cost an additional $382,000 to do that. We believe, because we've been looking around to re-up with a contract service, it's going to cost us about $3 million more than it is. And you know what our plan is see how well this works. Takes care of our custodian issues, takes care of our bus driver issues, and then our plan would be for the 18-19 year to take that across the county. The digital learning initiative, we've given teachers all this training, and they all have computers that are 7, 8, 10 years old. So what we want to do is put new devices in the hands of all of our teachers and go on a 3-year rotating lease, and that's right at $600,000. Need to put a little bit more in our instrumental music program, and that total comes up to $46,143,000. That's what we're respectfully requesting. You can see the capital outlay. Again, if it hadn't been for bond, hadn't been for lottery, we'd be in much worse shape than we were in. Now, 2 years ago, we talked about the current expense share of our budget, and we made plans. I think Brian, Craig, Susan, and we worked on how we could find money through some bond leftover money, some lottery money, and a couple of other. We came across a capital fund balance that we had, so we didn't really ask for anything capital. We asked for about $500,000 last year. I think you gave us Well, actually, it did give us a half a million. At the end, we asked you to move 250 over to current expense, but you can see what capital projects we have there, and that's what we're asking of you, and we appreciate your support, and I'll be happy to respond to any questions.
Let me ask you a question. You have on here a transfer to charter schools for $2.1 million, is that correct? I believe, and
that's
then,
what's correct, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. And then $93,000 extra for growth. Now, is that money just per pupil allotment?
It is.
Okay, what's that figure now? Do you know?
Shannon, what's that figure? About eight.
No, per pupil.
Per pupil is
per pupil
about,
cost.
I can have that for you tomorrow. It's a little over $8,000. The per pupil is a little bit misleading in that the state funds teachers, and they fund them at their salary. So they don't fund the position. They fund the position. They don't. If they fund it at the average salary, I'm not making myself clear, Tim, I know what I want to say. If I have a 25-year veteran teacher, the state will pay the school system to pay that teacher the actual salary, $55,000. If I have a brand new teacher, the state will pay the school system $35,000 for that new teacher. So a school system that has a lot of old teachers, when 80% of your budget is personnel, close to 90%, if you have a lot of veteran teachers, that per pupil expenditure is going to go up.
Sure.
If you have a lot of young folks, it's going to go down. And that's why we don't have the figure on that. But what goes to the charter school would be the state share, which is about $5,200, certain federal dollars, and then the local figure that you said.
I had a question, I just forgot what it was. But I did calculate out the increase amount of $7.9 million and divided it by the ADM, so that's about $347.80 per student.
Increase this year that we asked.
Increase over last year, right. Oh, I know what I was going to ask. On the capital, that adds up to $750,000. Does that include what we give to the school system out of like lottery money?
No, sir.
No, so that lottery money would be in addition.
Right.
Dr. Harrison, I have some questions. One of the things that I campaigned on, and I publicly spoke about it at the ABSS joint session with county commissioners, and you and I had spoken about it, was that I would not vote for a budget increase that was not accompanied by a commitment to concrete and quantitative or numerical data that measures school success. And I see tonight you have these very interesting charts up, the growth in the schools, the number of schools meeting their growth goals, but I noticed that you don't have any goals. We know that what gets measured gets done, and one of the best, I mean, how do we even know when we've achieved world-class status if we don't set an objective? The benchmarks that we have in our strategic plan, most of them, from my reading, are publish and form kind of things to complete the activities. We know in that strategic plan element has been completed because we have published or informed some group that we've done it. There's no quantitative measurement about what I actually accomplished. In my campaign, I spoke to a lot of people who said that they support public education, and public education is definitely not a Democrat or Republican issue. It's an issue for everyone.
Right.
But there's a lot of frustration with people feeling that public education is an endless pit, that it's a bureaucracy that can never be fed enough. And I think that people are willing to support it more if they feel that there is a concrete return on their investment, which is easily seen. I looked at your website just now. I don't see anything on the ABSS website that's a commitment to these are our goals. This is where we want to be. This is our teacher turnover rate is this now. We want it to be this in the future. I don't see where you have a graduation rate
This is our graduation right now. This is what I want it to be in 3 years or 5 years or whatever. And I've never said that I would dictate or consider myself in a position to dictate to the school system what those measurements should be or what those goals should be. But I do think that it is very reasonable for the citizens of Alamance County to expect the Alamance-Burlington school system to commit to some kind of quantitative measurement that they don't have to go over to the Department of Public Instruction website and wade around through a bunch of report cards. Okay. Then who even knows what that mess means? I think that if this school system expects the kind of commitment from the taxpayer that's going to result in some kind of transformation of the school system, it's entirely reasonable of the taxpayer to expect the school system to commit to some kind of standard of measurement where we know that our money has been well spent and not a bottomless pit. Now let me say that it's clear that when you go put a new roof on a building, there's not going to be some kind of a measurable accomplishment as far as growth in the student, or you paint a building. You know, those kind of things aren't necessarily transformative in a way that's easily seen in a graph. But there are other things that you can put in graphs. One thing that I saw on the Wake County website, and I actually have screenshots of it that we can take a look at together, but I don't want to take a lot of time. One thing that they have is what percentage of the graduates of the school system need remediation when they go to the community college. I would be fascinated to know that for the Alamance-Burlington school system. How many of our students, when they go to ACC, they have to take remedial math or remedial English because our CP or honors classes or AP classes that they're taking hasn't prepared them for the community college. Do you have a response to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, those figures that I put up there are tangible evidences of improvement. There are certainly many, many figures that we could use and many measures that we could use. We need to look at the website and see how we can make that more transparent if people are having a difficult time finding that. I wrestle with developing the targets and the benchmarks. I understand the need for that. I think, you know, Edwards Deming, who is the guru of quality, talked about meaningless, arbitrary numerical targets. So, and we did set some numbers, and we have those, and we've been back and forth about putting those up. Like, take the graduation rate. Our graduation rate is right at 80%. It's up 8 or 12% over the last 4 or 5 years. To me, the only acceptable graduation rate is 100%, because if I don't say my goal is 100%, I'm writing kids off. And whose kid am I writing off? I'm not going to write mine off. I'm not going to write mine off. I'm not going to write others. We know there are circumstances that are going to result in students not graduating. And so I wrestle with that, and we talk very seriously with our principals about numbers. I mean, we sit down at the end of the year. We sit down 4 times a year, and we talk about continuous improvement. We have set proficiency goals, and what Steve Aki has done is he's put together trajectory charts for schools. So if our target is 85%, and that's what we landed on, Andrew? So our target is 85%. For the school that is at 81% right now, that's not a big stretch. But at the school that's at 45% right now, that's a real big stretch. So if I'm saying I'm gonna go from 45 to 85% in 5 years, am I being realistic? And then what happens when you have goals that people perceive as not being realistic, they don't take them seriously. And so he's saying 100% graduation rate, he's saying 100% this, and he's not serious. He's just a superintendent up there talking. So what we've been able to share, if I'm at 81% right now, what do I have to do for ABSS to be at 85% in 5 years? So while it's a county goal of 85, my goal, it might be 97. If I'm that school that 45%, my goal for 5 years might be 75%. So we've looked at all of our schools and what's it going to take to get there. And the other thing, I think it's important that all of our schools are different challenges. Principals responsible for the individual school. I'm responsible for the school system. And I don't like comparing schools with schools. And I can remember, you know, the A through F grading system. I was chairman of the state board when they began talking about that. And I can remember standing in front of the Joint Ed Oversight. And I said, if you guys adopt this into law, we can save a lot of money on testing. Because we don't need to test anybody for me to tell you who the A's and the F's are. Because it's going to be aligned, almost perfectly correlated with poverty. And we've seen that. We've seen that in our district. We've seen that at the state level. We've seen it at the system level. So what I share with the board is always around county numbers. And I don't say that here's East Lawn, here's Smith, here's South Mebane. I say here are our 26 elementary schools and where they are. But we do sit down and have serious conversations with our principals about those things. We'll have a conversation, and we talked about this, I think, when we had our joint meeting, and we'll revisit the Wake site, and we'll get some more things up there.
Excuse me, I mean to interrupt. Charlotte Mecklenburg is buried in their their strategic plan. It's not as easily accessible on their website, but they have concrete goals and things that they've set out. And I appreciate all the things that you just said. And that is why I say, I'm not an educator. I respect your profession. I respect the school board. But my job, our job, is to look out for the taxpayer. And so that's one important thing I wanted to raise tonight. Another important thing I wanted to raise was that I do support public education very, very strongly, very firmly. But this budget makes it super hard for me to do that, because the amount of increase that you all have asked for, 20% increase, is more than the entire budget that we allocate to the Department of Social Services. The Department of Social Services gets $4.3 million from the county. And y'all have asked for an increase of, well, I guess you know.
7.8
million. So you all want more as an increase than the whole Department of Social Services gets for their whole budget from the county. Obviously, they get money from the federal government, like you all do. Obviously, they get money from the state, like you all do. I was frankly shocked that y'all asked for inflation increases in your budget. In looking through this budget book, I didn't see any county department that asked for an inflation increase. I'm sure somebody will correct me if I'm mistaken in that. I thought that was very surprising. And I have the fortune to attend your school board meetings as a representative of the county commissioners. Obviously, I don't vote. I have no personal stake in it. But I never heard the school board discuss what's the financial impact here of what we're talking about. And if we were to increase your budget by $7.8 million, Mr. County Manager, can you tell us what kind of property tax increase that would represent?
Based on our current valuation, which I'll talk about when I present our, we're projecting a penny to be $1.3 million. So I think Susan's got her calculator out more accurate than my brain.
Six.
So it'd be 6 cents.
So y'all have come in here asking for a 6 cents property tax increase, which I appreciate that ABSS does important work and does great work. But when you ask for something, and I understand your commitment to each child, but when you ask for a property tax increase like that, that's taking food off of people's table so that they can pay their property taxes. And I never heard any kind of discussion of anything like that at the school board meetings. I cannot support a budget that is this extreme. I just truly cannot. I also had other questions. I don't want to take up all the time. I'm sure the other commissioners have questions too. I was confused seeing that the bond architect and engineering support on our page 250, that $250,000 is listed there. I thought y'all already paid that. You've already hired an architect. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And so how are they being paid? Are they hoping that this budget comes through?
We have some money in our capital outlay budget. However, if
So you can see how that creates in the eye of someone like me kind of a shell game. We're going to take this $250 and move it around, and we're going to ask for it, but we kind of already have it, and we're just going to shift it to other things. That's confusing. Also, I was really disappointed that y'all did not bid out your architect. That's a $250,000. I'm sure that if you didn't bid it out, then the statutes didn't require you to. But to spend $250,000 on an architect, I would have thought the school board would have bid that out and looked for a good deal.
We interviewed. We did not bid out. We had a very specific scope of work. We will bid out when we get to the actual building and the design. This is simply to look at the feasibility, look for land for a new high school. It's to look at the renovation to Eastern, Western, Southern, Graham, Williams, Cummings. It's to look at the addition at South Mebane. It's to look at what it's actually going to take for us to get Pleasant Grove up to speed.
I understand. That's a very comprehensive and difficult thing. I can understand. I guess it costs $250,000 to get an architect to look over a school system the size of ours. I don't understand why y'all didn't bid it out, and I don't understand why it's in your budget if y'all are already paying for it. And I don't mean to pick on you tonight, Dr. Harrison.
I'm used to it.
I understand that your budget proposal was around $2.2 million, and that it was the school board members who applied pressure, and there was rigorous discussion about fulfilling the vision plan and or the strategic plan, and but those were my concerns. I don't mean
now, the board and I are a team, and we work in this thing together, and I happen to think at the end of the day they were right on this thing, or I would have pushed a little bit. But we need to maintain that commitment to that vision, because I think we owe it to our kids. I think when I look east and I look west and see what school systems are doing, when I think about the couple years I spent as superintendent in Orange County and the resources that I had at my disposal there, I think our kids deserve what they get.
Well, I feel very strongly that over time, property values increase when public education is supported. And we need to support public education over time because we will see a corresponding result in increasing property values, improving home equity in our homes. The average home in Alamance County is worth between $137,000 and $140,000. In Orange County, it's worth $270,000. That's huge. You know, I would love to have another $100,000 of equity in my home. Instead, when I got my property tax evaluation, my home had decreased by $15,000 in 5 years. But that's the economic reality we live in. When you say every child is important and we want to serve them, we also want them to have a roof over their head. Tax foreclosure is a real thing, and people really struggle. Do I pay my buy my medicine, do I buy food, or do I pay for my housing? And I cannot support a budget request that really puts incredible pressure on people to stay in their home.
I have 6 cents on a $150,000 house is probably less than $150 a year.
Yes, I think so. I don't have that in front of me, but I believe so, yes.
I mean, that's a big increase. But on a $150,000 house, it's $150 a year, less than $150.
The other thing I wanted to mention is that within that, a 6 cents increase now, then there's the bond. If it passes, then there'll be a tax increase to pay for the bond. And then we have a new high school. Then the size of the school system has gotten bigger because we got to put teachers in those classrooms and school bus drivers and assistant principals and a principal. Then we have another increase in the size of the school system's budget. I think that I'm not alone in feeling like the wheels are spinning. And I want, as a citizen, as a taxpayer myself, I want to know that this school system is committed to the results they expect to get from all this spending. And I think that that is reasonable to have your charts on the internet so people can see and set some goals.
Got it.
Very good. Comments?
Well, I'd like to say not in disagreement at all. I would like to say what you cited is the obvious. I've been on this board. This is my 21st budget. This is your first. And I remember the first time the increase over and above the previous year in reoccurring expense was $3 million. It went to $7 million, went to $10 million, now it's up to $12 million. It's you know, we'll make a decision, and when that decision comes, it might not be what everybody wants, but it's a situation of where Jeannie needs braces, Johnny needs shoes, and let mom and dad figure out how to pay for it. And Jeannie doesn't care much about Johnny, and Johnny doesn't care about Jeannie's braces. Everybody wants what they want. And I mean that with all due respect. This is a wish list. This is, and I don't criticize you for asking for it. But our decision will have to be whether we feel like, you know, we could pay for these things with and sleep at night.
Bob, comments? Bill?
I have to say I agree with Amy. I just can't see raising taxes on the taxpayers 6 cents for a school that's failing, and it's failing every year. You can show us all the graphs, but the teachers that I've talked to and when I was running for this job tell me that until you get discipline in your public schools, you're not going to have a public school if you don't start changing and putting some discipline in. It's just that simple. I hear a lot of things that y'all don't hear because y'all talk to each other. The school board talks to you, and you talk to the school board, and the school board don't listen to the people who vote for them.
I can assure you the phone calls that I get from school board members, they listen to the people that vote for them. The board and I are in schools twice a month, eating lunch, walking around, visiting classrooms. I get into each school. My goal is once a month. I made it to each school 8 times last year. Some a few less than that, a few more. But I would say that I'm fairly visible in the schools, and I think most teachers would tell you that. Now, they got to realize that they see me in their school 8 times, but I'm doing
That is true.
And, you know, we have, you know, to the discipline issue, I can safely say that our schools are safe places for kids. Now, do we have some kids with some mental health issues? Do we have some kids who make bad choices? Absolutely, every place does. But I've not walked down a hall that I wouldn't feel comfortable with my child going to school every day.
Your problem is not your hall. Your problem is your classrooms. That's where your problems are. As a superintendent, you should know that.
I think I have a pretty good handle on what's happening in our schools. I don't just sit in the office when I go there. I walk. If I talk with the principal, we walk and talk. And the only time we're sitting in that office is during those quarterly formal evaluations or if there's a problem we've got to talk about. But I don't, you know, my visits to the schools are not going out there and sitting in the office and having coffee with the principal. I go in, I talk with teachers when they're on planning period and when there are PLCs, and I understand that the game changes, the conversation changes when I walk into the building. I see nice guy Bill, they see the superintendent, and I recognize that, and I recognize they're probably not going to share some things they might with others, with me, but I would think that it's been almost 3 years now that I've been here. I have interacted on a regular basis with a lot of teachers. Those 50 We've had 105 teachers go through the Teacher Leadership Academy. Those are 9 day-long sessions, and I go to every one of those, and I stay all day long, and I sit at tables with teachers, and I interact with. So I would say there are a couple hundred teachers out there that know me, and I think are comfortable telling me what I need to know. We had an issue that arose at a school right before the holidays, and I went out and got the Teacher Leadership Academy folks together. I said, I need to ask you some questions. And they're very professional, but they spoke openly and honestly with me. But I think the teacher working condition survey, you know, that's not where I want that to be either. You know, my goal there, Amy, is 85. I mean, I'm pretty clear about that. But we'll have some conversations about those targets, and we'll get something up there a little more visible.
So I would say that, Amy, I appreciate all your comments. From a management perspective and my background in management, setting goals, and there's a lot of merit to that. But I understand your response to that too, Dr. Harrison. But I ran on a platform of supporting public education because I know that investing in public education is going to generate those returns, and it's returns over a long period of time. It's hard to see immediate results. And you've shown some good results in a very short period of time, but the real return is gonna come later. I know that there are a lot of people who work in this community, professional people with really good paying jobs who don't live here because they think it's better for their kids to live in another community. So that means that their nice property taxes are going to another community, and that's where they're doing their shopping. So we're losing out on some economic development opportunity in that. And I just really believe that the public education is foundational to everything else in our community, like one of the speakers said earlier, that it's so important. It's the economic development strategy if you're talking about prosperity for all, because when each of our kids are prosperous, then we're all going to prosper. And I would also say, with respect to accountability, it's really, we need to have a whole community behind public education. As Dr. Harrison mentioned, I mean, our kids are coming from lots of different environments that impede their progress. And yes, you can be responsible for growth to a large extent, but you can't do it by yourself because the kids aren't in school 24 hours a day. They're in other environments. And that's where we have other community types of supports that come into play that touch our kids in ways that can help to improve their educational experience. And I'm speaking of our health department and our social services department and Impact Alamance and Alamance Achieves and just that whole plethora of this energy grid that we have out there that kids can plug into. All that is very important for outcomes as well. So it's hard to hold ABSS by itself accountable for certain of those goals because it takes the whole community. ABSS is just part of that. But in general, I'm very supportive of investing in public education, and we'll have to see as we continue with our budget deliberations after the presentations this evening and at our next meeting how it all shakes out. But so those are my comments.
And thank you, Dr. Harrison, for coming tonight. Thank you, all the commissioners, for your comments, Amy. I agree, we do need a little better accountability for the public to see. And of course, you are the first one on our list. You had 11 pages. I think we had like 600 and some here. We're going to eventually go through and decide how to make this work.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you.
And I have to run, so I'm not going to weigh in on this.
Well, and we may just take a short recess because of that. How about that? Let's take a break, and we'll come back in 10 minutes. Welcome, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. It's a pleasure to be here this evening to share our budget request with you, and I say this budget request is being made on behalf of the Board of Trustees. It's made on behalf of our students and our faculty, our staff, and the entire Alamance County. I have with me this evening Cindy Colley, who is the Chief Financial Officer. If you can't trust my numbers, you can certainly trust hers. She is quite a talented financial person with some 16 plus years of experience in the business. So I have a slide presentation this evening. So let me give you sort of an introduction to what we'll talk about. I'll give you a very high level overview of the college. We'll talk about some milestones, some of our partnerships, some student successes, economic impact of Alamance Community College to Alamance County. And then I'll ask Cindy Collar to come forward and speak specifically about the numbers, the data, what it means, and what your investment will do for Alamance Community College. We've been in business, or should I say that we have been providing workforce training, educational training and services to this county for some 59 years, almost 60 years. We're not a new institution in terms of community colleges in this nation. We're about the right age. We're the 14th largest community college in the state of North Carolina, and there are 58 community colleges in this state. So we're pretty high up on the chain. We offer more than 35 curriculum programs and diploma programs, ranging from nursing to university transfer to welding, machining, and our workforce development in which we used to refer to as continuing education. That part of our college works more with short-term training to prepare workers for emergency services, basic law enforcement, paramedics, EMT, and all of those services that we have to have on a daily basis. And I think you will agree with me that when we need someone to on call for fire protection, or when we go to the pharmacy and we order medication, or when we need basic law enforcement personnel, we want the very best and the very best trained that we can find. We don't want less than the best, or at least I don't. Corporate education is another part of what we do through the short-term training. And this is, I think this is impressive, at least it is to me. Over the last year, we've had $3.7 million worth of funding that has flown through the corporate education department and gone to support training in a variety of new and expanding industries and businesses here in this county: Cambro, GKN, Walmart, Logistics, Carolina Biological, Glen Raven, and that list goes on. But that gives you hopefully some sense about what we do in terms of the curriculum programs, continuing education, workforce development. Some major milestones over the last year. You may have noticed when I started the slide, the very first one is a picture of an incredibly beautiful, state-of-the-art, first-class building for which you should be extremely proud, and that is our Advanced Applied Technology Building. We're very excited about it. The schedule was to have it ready for occupancy in the fall of 2017, and we're on schedule to do that. That building will house jobs that are highly unlikely to be sent away from this country, away from this county. It will house jobs training programs that pay living wage salaries. So students who go through these programs and go to work will make incredibly good salaries. And those programs are welding, automotive technology, computer integrated machining, heating, ventilating, and air conditioning technology. Now tell me how we can outsource HVAC to a company that's not pretty close by. We don't want to wait for a day or two or a week to have our air conditioners repaired during the heat of August or July. By the same token, we don't want to wait during January and December to have our heat repaired. When we need these people to come and repair our appliances, then we need them then, not weeks later. And this is what we do, what we will do in the new Advanced Applied Technology Building. We have done the very best job in our history in terms of grants. Those are dollars coming in from non-state sources, and primarily non-state sources and non-county sources. $1.8 million awarded to the college over the last year. That has included some sizable grants, $1 million Department of Labor grant to prepare technicians for one of the skill areas that is in high demand and where there are shortages, and that's in mechatronics. A Golden Leaf grant for $200,000 This was to purchase mechatronics equipment to go in the new building that you are financing. A $200,000 National Science Foundation grant to help prepare faculty members to do a better job in the areas of science, technology, and engineering so that we can get students from the point of entry to employment faster and more effectively. But we've added some new programs recently. Mechatronics is new. That's the first new program that the college has introduced, I think, over a period of some 15 to 16 years. Now, it is imperative that we keep pace with the workforce and training needs of the future. And I argue that the future is here now. So we have to ensure that our complement of programs never become stagnant for a long period of time ever again. Histotechnology and bioinformatics. And those programs will feed the new Biotechnology Center of Excellence, which hopefully you've heard about, you've read about in the media. The Biotechnology Center of Excellence is going to produce better training, faster training, for more jobs to help sort of bridge this gap that we have in the biotechnology arena between the triad and the triangle. I was reading work of some major economists, and one of the things that caught my eye was the fact that they mentioned that if you want to have economic development over and above having a community college, then of course you want to pay attention to clusters and different affiliates of workforce that comes with those clusters. So biotechnology in this county, we're right between one of the largest clusters in the state, and I dare say the world. So histotechnology and bioinformatics and mechatronics, all of those will feed into this concept of biotechnology. We've also added the associate in engineering. I like to use the example of a student going off to a four-year college to become an engineer, and a student who is at a community college training to become an engineer. Obviously, the community college student would be done in about 2 years, and at Alamance Community College with zero debt. So that student will be able to invest him or herself into our workforce, pay into our tax base in just 2 years, in some cases less. The university student, and I'm an advocate for universities, I'm a product of a university. Notwithstanding, the university student will probably end up with a tremendous amount of debt in 4 years and will have to pay back on the loans that he or she has received, while our student has already worked for 2 years and made a really good living. And I could stand here and talk about those kind of examples all night, but we have to get to the dollars and cents, no pun intended with the cents. The Career Accelerator Program. Hopefully you will appreciate the partnership that Alamance Community College has with a number of local industry members, GKN, Glen Raven, Ferristone Fabrics, Sandvik, Engineered Controls, Technical Precision Plastics, and what used to be called NIPRO. Now, you can help me pronounce what it is tonight. Now, is it Jabul? Let's just call it NIPRO. NABSS and the Chamber of Commerce. Realizing these industry folks are very bright. They realize that there is a shortage. I don't go back to a mechatronics technician. GKN made it very clear to us a couple years ago, maybe a year ago, and they said, you know, and these are my words, not theirs, I'm paraphrasing, that you provide the training we need to keep industry here, but we have to go somewhere else to get it. And I want to be very clear in that statement, go somewhere else to get the training. But by the same token, they could have said we could move the industry to go where a trained workforce is. When industry considers where to land, where to locate their companies, one of the first things they do is look at the local community college or discern if there is a local community college. Let me interject something here. According to the Department of Labor and a lot of other economists, by the year 2020, well, we're really there. Like I said, the future is now. I think I said that. But by the year 2020, a high school diploma will not cut it anymore. In order to get a meaningful job that pays a decent salary, one needs higher education. Now get this. I think the data depends on whose data you read. About 2/3 of all workers will require education beyond high school. But most of the 2/3 will require less than a 4-year degree. Again, nothing against 4-year colleges, but the action, where is the action? You can answer that question. It's in community colleges. That's exactly where it is. And how fortunate we are to have Alamance Community College. Although I praise what we do in short-term training, I praise what we do in the technical fields, and there's still the need for university-educated people. So what are we doing about that? We have partnerships. We have partnerships with a number of universities, Guilford College, to provide yet another avenue for students to get an education. UNC Greensboro School of Nursing, you know, many years ago, many in, let's say, 25, 30 years ago, LPN was, that was what you needed to get a job, licensed practical nursing degree. And that made its way to eventually an ADN, associate degree in nursing. The associate degree in nursing is still of very, very high value. However, there is more emphasis as of late being placed on the BSN, the Bachelor of Science in Nursing degree. So to ensure that our students, our graduates, have an opportunity to earn the BSN degree, we partnered with UNC Greensboro. So now a student can come to Alamance Community College, earn 2 years an associate degree, stay at Alamance Community College, earn 2 more years and a BSN through the University of North Carolina at Greensboro, and never leave Alamance Community College. What a deal that is. What a deal that is for our students, for this county. Now, the unfortunate thing is that we have an aging population, along with the young folks, of course. And because of access to health care being increased, there's greater demand for the services of nurses. So these are, again, jobs that are going to be here. Elon University, I believe there's someone in the audience from Elon. So let me say that Elon has just done an incredible job partnering with us. We have our first ever transfer articulation degree with Elon University. And I believe I shared with you last year that Elon stepped up to the plate and offered a transfer scholarship, reducing the cost to worthy students from Alamance Community College to go on to a wonderful university and never leave this county. It's a great deal. North Carolina A&T, and I won't go through this full list, but when I talked about the employment outlook and the future of jobs and the skill shortages, science, technology, engineering, and math, that's where the greatest shortages are. But that's also the area that requires the greatest amount of skill and talent. So we are purposely developing articulation agreements with 4-year colleges and universities that lead to degrees in engineering and science and technology and math. The UNC Transfer Excellence Program, which is not on this screen, is one of the older, more successful programs we have. Student comes to Alamance Community College, earns a 3.2 grade point average, guaranteed admissions to UNC Chapel Hill, guaranteed. And because they are a community of people, we have a community here, and that community makes its way to UNC Chapel Hill, then they have a lot of built-in wraparound support, and they get extra support there, and that community kind of stays together. So those students tend to be very successful. I want to go back to nursing just for a moment with the UNCG articulation program. In December of 2016, we graduated our first class. We started this program, I believe in 2015, we graduated the first class. We started with 25 students. 22 graduated. Don't get discouraged. The three that haven't are working on finishing up their work. So the expectation is that there will be a 100% graduation rate of our students. ABS partnership. There is no way that we can prepare the future workforce without partnering with Alamance Burlington School System. We have to do everything within our resources to ensure that students have an opportunity to continue their academic career past or post high school, because that's where the job's going to be. Without that, then those students will become, how can I spin this positively? Let me do it this way. Let me say it this way. The students who will go on and get a good education will be able to pay into our tax base. I'm reminded of this note. The rising cost of not going to college is a debt everyone pays. And that's not a direct quote from me. The rising cost of not going to college is a debt that everyone pays. So these partnerships are critical. I won't be too repetitive. Dr. Williamson spoke about the middle college and the early college, and this is how we get young people in the pipeline for college early. Middle college and early colleges are designed for first generation, low income, socially economically disenfranchised students. And those are exactly the students that we are attracting. Those students, when challenged appropriately, can do exceptionally well, and they have proven that this is true. Korean College Promise Program is a state program that provides free tuition to high school students to take college courses while they're still in high school. It may not be on your slide, but this is very important. And we have increased the number of those students from some 300 and some students to well over 700, closer to 800 than 700. So that means that we are getting more and more students in this pipeline, if you will, to go continue at Alamance Community College and to go on from there and be ready for the workforce. Student successes, there are many. Many student successes, but let me highlight just a few. I just told you or shared with you the successes we're having with the transfer articulation agreement with the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. Recently, our Phi Theta Kappa organization, which is the oldest international honor society for community colleges, went to a regional awards, well, it wasn't an awards, but it was a regional conference or program, and walked away with 10 awards. I don't know how they can do that. I can go to programs all day and walk away with my agenda. No awards. The horticulture program just came back from Brigham Young University in Utah, competing on a national scale with universities and community colleges from all over the state in horticulture. How did they do? Let me share with you how they did. They did very well. This is national competition. They finished second among all community colleges participating and 11th among all universities and community colleges combined. Exceptionally well. You've heard me speak about horticulture before. They have an incredible reputation. So much so that this same competition that they went to just a few weeks ago, that was held at Mississippi State University last year, Brigham Young this year, well, guess where it's going to be next year? Come on, you can guess this. Alamance Community College. Yes. So we're expecting, according to Justin Snyder, our renowned horticultural leader, we're expecting some 1,500, I'll scale it back a little bit, let's say 1,200 people from outside of this county, and many of which, will be from outside of this state, all across this nation, to land here in Alamance County next year. And it's my anticipation that they will spend money on hotels, that they would spend money on rental cars, that they will spend money on gas, that they would spend a lot of money on food. And that means tax revenue for this county. But it means more than tax revenue. It is about building upon the wonderful reputation that has already been built with horticulture. And it's like Nordstrom's when you go in a mall. You know, you may go to Nordstrom's, or you may go to Belk's, or you may go to JCPenney's, and then you have all these other shops to get the benefit. But the person didn't really go to the mall to shop at the other shops. They went to Nordstrom's, but then they learned that those other shops were there, and they have a wonderful shopping experience. But same thing here. They'll come to Alamance County, and they'll have a wonderful experience, hopefully shopping here in our county. I'm so proud of this next note that I want to point out. We started a year or so ago sort of a debate club, mock trial, and our students are doing very well. They are one of only two community colleges in this state that competes. The other one is Chemeketa from Oregon. Can't wait to see the president of Chemeketa. So here's what we did. Alamance Community College competed with all these major universities, Duke University, Davidson, William & Mary, UNC Charlotte, Wake Forest. The competition was held at Campbell University Law School in Raleigh. Well, we succeeded over, God, this is great. We succeeded over UNC Charlotte. That's pretty good. Alamance Community College. Last year, we succeeded over Campbell University. President Nito Cabin, I can't wait to have another conversation with him to talk about that. The point I'm making here is that we have quality teaching and learning opportunities for students, and that we truly are making a difference in a huge way, that we're being recognized not only by community colleges in this state, but by four-year colleges and universities, renowned institutions. I can continue with student successes. We will be here all night, won't we? ACC named Rhino Center Project Site. So there are several skill sets that are required in today's workforce. The literature says that the skills include, but may not be limited to, the following. Communication skills, the ability to write and to speak well. Not just the skill set of a particular curriculum, but communication skills, the ability to work in groups, collaborate, solve problems, think critically, and use technology. So this is one where we believe that we had an opportunity to enhance. So Alamance Community College is, I believe, the only community college in this state that has taken such a grand step to really focus on better preparing faculty and coordinating with the local public schools and to ensure that our students are taught the best communication skills, the best writing skills that we can possibly deliver. A couple more student successes and we'll move on. The CLAP Entrepreneurial Opportunity Initiative started last year. $10,000 prize to the student who comes up with the best business plan of a real situation, a real business plan. So we had a student who won the $10,000 prize locally, and then she competed on a statewide basis for a $1,000 prize and won that. The point here is that she was good here, and she is good statewide, and I would dare to say nationally. Again, preparation. Economic impact. So what does all of this mean in terms of Alamance County? And this is where it gets down to dollars and cents. What is the economic impact? Now, this is not some figure that we made up. This figure was discerned or developed by EMSI, which is one of the leading business and education economic modeling specialists in the nation. $200 million per year. That's the economic impact. $200 million per year. And the return on the investment is just as impressive. For every dollar invested, the $4.50 return on investment. If only I had been able to purchase stocks that would give me that kind of return on investment, you probably wouldn't have to listen to this long discourse. But that is something that hopefully you are very proud of. Our budget request is for $5,152,525. I would ask Ms. Collett to make her way to the podium now. But before she gets here, I was just thinking while I was sitting in my seat, what is that? What does $5 million mean in terms of the number of students that we prepare each year? Roughly speaking, we prepare about 15,000 students. And I'm going to be quite honest with you, that includes short-term training as well as associate degree and certificates. But if you do the math on that, it's not a huge figure if you look at it on a student-by-student basis. It's, what, in the neighborhood of $400 per student, maybe less? Again, we have Cindy to do the math problems here. If you base that on the full-time equivalency of the college, about 4,500 on the FTE, it comes out to be less than $1,200. So your return on investment is probably bigger than $4.50 if you really begin to get into the weeds on that. Cindy, please come forward. So now I'd like for Cindy Collett to speak more in detail about the specifics around our budget request. And hopefully, Cindy, you will address how the budget request is somewhat skewed, and it's skewed because of HVAC, heating, ventilating, and air conditioning. 45-year-old system, I think it's served its time and done very well, but its time is up. And that has certainly helped to skew our budget. Cindy, if you come forward, and after she finishes, we'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Okay. Good evening. So now the fun part for the numbers. So before I start on the numbers, just a quick snapshot of what the county funds support at the college. Of course, we have over 455,000 square feet of buildings. And eight of these buildings are primary instructional facilities, and we have 140 acres of land. And county funds support 2 full-time grounds staff, 3 full-time public safety personnel, and 16 part-time public safety officers. And with our state-supported funds, we have over 800 employees. And as Dr. Gatewood said, we support 15,000 students annually. And Dr. Gatewood said we're requesting a little over $5 million is our budget request this year, which is made up of our current expense of $3,324,025 and our capital outlay request of $1,828,500. Again, that capital outlay number is a little skewed because the significant portion of that is for phase two of our HVAC project, which is a little over $1.3 million, which if some of you will recall, that was in our budget request from last year as well. And our next slide, I'll do similar to Dr. Harrison did in his presentation. I just wanted to highlight a few of the things that we were able to do with county funds in fiscal year 2017. We were able to enhance our public safety department by hiring two additional full-time public safety officers. Until this year, we only had one full-time public safety officer, so we continue to enhance our public safety department. We were able to complete our B building stairs project. So we put a brand new set of stairs into our B, what we call our B building. They were a safety concern for many years. We were the third bullet point, we were able to complete phase one of our HVAC project with a combination of county funds and state funds. And the fourth bullet point, we were able to provide a 1.5% pay raise, recurring pay raise for our county-funded employees, and a $1,100 one-time bonus for our county-funded employees, which was consistent with what we provided our state employees. And to talk about our current expense request, I've split this up into two items. Essentially, it's very basic and straightforward. It's salary and benefits is one part of it, and then the other part is to support operations for the new Advanced Applied Technology Center. I don't have it split up exactly like that on this slide, but so the first item, salary and benefits, which of course would be any pay increases, which is that would be comparative to what state employees would get, which they are predicting a 2% salary increase. We would also like to add another public safety officer, another grounds keeper if we could, and also pay for half of a capital projects coordinator, assistant director position out of county funds. Then the second item, to increase plant operations for $151,000. The big portion of this is to fund the operating expenses for the Advanced Supply Technology Center for $135,000, which is just asking for three quarters of the year because the Advanced Supply Technology Center, of course, will not be open until August. And here is our capital request. Again, as I mentioned earlier, this looks a little skewed because the big portion of that is for the HVAC system, which is the $1.3 million. The HVAC project is split into four phases. Of course, we were able to finish the first phase during this fiscal year. Now we're on to phase two, which would be $1.3 million. And ideally, we'd like to complete the next three phases over the next three fiscal years, if funds were available. Then we just move into our repairs, renovations, modernizations of classrooms, and if we were to get our regular appropriation for capital, we could cover most of these, except for the HVAC system. So the HVAC is really what's skewing the number. It's above and beyond what we ask for. And again, just to run through these really quick, this modernization of our dental program, again, painting, refinishing for classrooms, renovating our advertising and graphics labs and classroom space. Our Dillingham Center needs three new air handling units. Again, renovating even more classrooms and replacing windows in our main building that are over 40 years old. and then campus safety improvements and campus maintenance for handrails and sidewalks. And the last slide that I have here is just some additional information just to show how efficiently we use our county funds. Current funding per full-time student is $700, and I believe in your budget package I gave some other community colleges and how they use their current funding per FTE in our peer group, and this information is collected by the state system office. So I just wanted to show how efficiently we're using our funds. And then our college strategic plan, we just wrapped up our strategic plan for 2014-2016, which is a 22-point strategic plan, very aggressive, and we are starting our new initiative strategic plan for the next 2 to 3 years.
Right here, so if there are okay. any questions, you can answer them.
Okay.
note, she said that the cost for FTE is $700, and I think I estimated it $400. Like I said, if you can't trust my numbers, you can trust hers. So I certainly agree with Cindy on that. So if there are any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. I do want to provide a slide. It's about economic vitality of this county. I think any of us would be hard-pressed to see Alamance County in bright terms without a strong and very vibrant Alamance Community College. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Questions for Cindy?
Well, I would like to ask a question, one tongue-in-cheek and a serious question. But the serious one, you've got 58 systems in the state, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, are there any systems where there's a collaborative effort between the counties for capital, or is it all just separate, all 58 systems separate?
Counties, partnership with the counties?
Right, in other words, for instance, well, it's no secret, you know, we have a lot of students coming in from out of county, and I would assume that Orange is the biggest. I may be wrong on that.
Right. We usually, I see what you're saying. Orange County and Durham County would just support Durham Tech.
Right.
Right. There would be no crossover. That's the way that the general statute is written. Does that answer your question?
Unless the two counties or the two colleges agree.
Right.
And then they can work together and partner on various.
Right.
But none of that's going on in North Carolina.
Not a lot of it, some.
I think maybe special programming sometime that you will collaborate with other community colleges.
Right.
I'm talking about capital, I'm not talking about operation.
Not to my knowledge, any capital crossover between counties.
To mine either, but it could be.
Now, tongue in cheek, you mentioned I'm a Campbell graduate. Not law school, but didn't you mention that y'all beat Campbell?
I said we beat UNC Charlotte.
Okay.
I don't know where Campbell fell in that line.
Yeah, you said something about Campbell, and then you said you.
Oh, that was one of the institutions that were one of the institutions that was competing.
Yeah.
It's high level institution was the point I was trying to make. And Alamance Community College is one of only two community colleges in the nation that competes at that level.
But after you said that, you said you couldn't wait to talk to Nito, and Nito's over at High Point University.
High Point University.
Yeah.
So, he's as passionate about High Point University as I am about Alamance Community College, so it would make great lunch talk.
Well, I do know that the community college has been very active in helping us with economic development and stepping up to the plate as we need the programs for the companies that are looking coming here. So, okay.
Any other? I think it goes right along. It's part of the whole continuum of public education that's so important. And you're offering that career end of the cradle to career continuum.
So let me just ask this for clarity. It looks like you're asking for a 48% budget increase, but that's really represented by a capital project and not an ongoing request.
Let me address that, Commissioner Gailey. I think what we're doing is we're asking very late in the game for something that maybe we should have asked for many years ago. We've been very, very fortunate to, in the air conditioning system, to last for 45 years. I don't know what the brand is, but
that's a long time.
That's a long time.
So it's sort of a, you hear about deferred maintenance. This is a deferred ask. This is a late ask. We should have asked for this a long time ago. We did ask for it last year with a clear understanding that you would allocate what you allocate. We'll do the best that, we would do the best that we could with, which I think we've done.
Maybe our HVAC students have been over there practicing on it and keeping it running.
Yeah,
that's helped.
Well, I just, one of the things that I learned when I went to commissioner training back, I guess, in January, talking to people from different counties around the state, is how really awesome Alamance County is with the different opportunities, that the different elements of that make up a community that we have. We have not just one interstate, but two. As one, we have a great community college, we have a university here, we have an airport, we have a railroad, we have so many things, we have good water through the city of Burlington. So I just think that ACC is an important part of all of that, and appreciate the work that y'all do.
Yep. We surely do. Yep.
Thank you very much.
We are the envy, aren't we?
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Next on the county government, I guess, Sheriff, you're up first.
We'll have breakfast delivered here shortly.
That sounds like a good idea.
That is a good idea.
Yeah, good idea. Right. Let me tell you something. I'm going to be fairly brief tonight because our budget will come in lower than what it was last year and because time's strange. But however, if you have any questions on any aspect of what I go over, for goodness sakes, please ask. You each have a folder with you that you can turn to. And page one, let's see if we can get started here. Do it out of my glasses. Okay, if our, I'm just going straight to the budget issues. Our current budget, our personnel costs for this past year would be $9,408,439. Our personnel cost for this year will be $9,810,971. That is an increase of $402,532. Now, that increase is because in the middle of the budget year, you were so graciously allowed us to attend more officers' positions, and that helped raise that particular cost. However, as we come down to the operating costs, you'll see that we had last year's budget, or current budget, $1,804,018, and we dropped our operating costs $1,457,306, which was a decrease of $346,712. And we had to do some fine-tuning to do that. But I knew that y'all were going to be confronted with the school system, the college, and we tried to trim our budget the best we could. Our capital outlay last year, or this current year, was $538,507, and we're coming in this year at our request at $402,000. Total expenditures last year, or current budget, was $11,750,964, and we'll be coming in at $11,670,277, which would be a decrease of technically of $80,687. And that's for the sheriff's operating side. All right, we go to the current detention budget. Our current budget personnel cost was $7,408,032. In our 17-18,000 budget, our personnel costs were requesting $7,282,598. So there is a decrease there. Our operating cost, current budget was $1,799,374, and we were able to trim our operating costs down a little bit to $2,739,364, which is a difference of $494,700 less than last year's budget. We actually have three budgets in the sheriff's office, like I said, our detention budget, our sheriff's side, and then we also have school resource officers. And basically, I'll just go real hurriedly with that. We're coming in under $4,618 less what this year's budget is, and that's because of transfer of personnel with lower salaries to the school system, new SROs coming on, et cetera. Okay, our stepping up initiative. This is entirely grant funded, so it's no increase, no decrease to the county. And I'm telling you, I am all excited about the stepping up initiative because I think it's really going to happen. And when it does, we'll be able to stop people that are being placed in our detention center to go, hopefully, to a diversion unit, get the proper medication and help they need, and not reoffend to be back in our custody. If you have any questions, I'm ready to take them. We did cut some monies, like I say, on other line items in both budgets to try to do this. And we're very appreciative. Now, I will say this, on our sheriff's budget, we employ 136 full-time employees and 15 temporary employees. We're not asking for no new personnel. The only thing we're asking for is that capital outlay, and the commissioners a couple years ago agreed to give the sheriff's office 12 cars every year to rotate out of our fleet because of the high mileage vehicles. There's $52,000 being requested to put our MDTs or MCTs, whatever you want to call them, in our 10 new deputy cars to cover the county, and those are mobile data terminals. As far as the jail budget, we have no new resource requests.
I was hoping that you were going to say the decrease in the jail budget was due to successful implementation of the stepping up initiative.
Well, let me say this. We are housing about 30 inmates for Randolph County and Stokes County, and I think it was 53 of the state misdemeanors through the state where we're getting funds holding those inmates. If we didn't hold those inmates, we would still need the staffing, we'd still have to pay for air conditioning and heating. The only thing that's costing us is the meters. So there is money coming in there, sir. But I would love to see someday, if we have to use that for our stepping up initiative.
Thank you. I would like to point out, and I don't mean this to be critical at all, but when you're comparing, you're saying that there's a little bit of a decrease in the regular sheriff budget. That's when it's compared to the amended budget of last year after we added the 10 deputies.
10 positions.
Yeah, so if you go back to the original adopted budget a year ago, that was $11.1 million. So you're projecting a 5.1% increase over that, because that's before we added those 10 deputies.
But we have to buy uniforms, we have to buy all the stuff for the officers.
Yeah. And was that included in the amendment last year?
Just the positions. Yeah, we did the positions last year, not the equipment, I don't think. Well, thank you for a very precise budget. And getting past our bedtime.
Please, if you have any questions, please ask.
Based on my memory, your jail budget's about where it was 2 years ago, wasn't it? I mean,
very close.
Yeah.
I mean, he's holding it. Yeah.
Very close.
So my hat's off to you there.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Good job.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right, social services. Susan?
Yes. So we'll be like the sheriff and we'll be brief. I'm proud to bring to you the DSS budget tonight from our executive leadership team. I think you'll see that this meets increasing demand for our services, utilizes state and federal grants to help provide for innovation and cutting-edge services to our citizens, and all of that without an increase in our budget. I'm going to turn things over to Kelly Inman, our Assistant Director for Operations, and she's going to take you through three or four short slides that explain our budget.
Absolutely. I will be brief. So this is just a graphic to show you the $6.1 million in mandated county spending to provide social services in our county. And we'll just get right into the budget numbers. The first thing you'll notice is that our expenditures and our revenues are both down about $4.5 million. And this has to do with pass-through funds for two programs that will no longer be paid at the county level. The eligibility for those services is still a DSS function, but those will be paid by NCFAST and NCTRACS. So that's why you see a difference of the expenditure and revenue numbers. So our county dollars are remaining flat at $7.4 million. So we are budget neutral. There is some movement within our budget lines. So the reason, we talked a little bit about the pass-through funds. Foster care is another area that we have had decreases in. So we budgeted $1.1 million this year. We're on track to spend $953,000. This is a result of fewer children who are qualifying for our 84% federal reimbursement services. More of our children are in the 50-50 area of reimbursement. But what we are seeing with our decreased cost is due to kinship placements. And so this is really a good thing for families and children, and it's less dollars in our budget. So we do have some personnel requests, six to be exact. We're asking for two income maintenance supervisors. This is to address our staff ratios that have just crept up over time, and also to be able to do more second-party reviews of our data. For better outcomes for our clients. And we expect around 50% reimbursement for those two positions. We're also looking for two new income maintenance workers that are reimbursed at 50 to 75%. And again, we have to address timeliness mandates that come down from the state. And we are currently, the federal government has put us on corrective action plans. That's the whole state of North Carolina. Not as specifically. also, we're asking for one extended hour social worker. This would be someone who would work 1 p.m. to 10 p.m. to handle investigations and assessments that more and more need to occur after hours so that both parents are in the home and home from their jobs. We're also asking for a clerical assistant. This is actually a state request as we get ready to enter the child welfare program into NCFAST. They are recommending that we add this position, and we're waiting to see. There might be some funding to come for that position. This slide is just, we wanted to make sure that you understand that we sat down with our strategic plan with our management team and made these decisions and built our budget around what would be customer focused for our citizens. And so the rectangles around the outside really represent what our action plan or agency day-to-day plan will be, everything that will be customer-centered. And those are the performance management goals that are in your packet. And those align with the goals set forth in the strategic plan around being a safety net provider and also that government accountability. Some other services that we're looking to add this year, of course, I'm sure Brian will speak to voice over IP. We will be responsible for the hardware for that. We would like to add ADA compliant door entrances to the Human Services Center. We're also looking at a learning management system. And again, I just wanted to bring focus to our commitment to second party reviewing our work. And that's where the supervisors and more workers come into play. So any questions or discussions that you have for me, I would just recap that we are budget neutral from our amended budget. A little movement within our budget, 6 new positions, and we're able to do that in a budget neutral environment because of the decrease in foster care.
Any questions?
I would add that you have a couple more sheets after social services. Those are our grant areas. So we have a Governor's Crime Commission grant and an Office of Violence Against Women grant. Those are cost neutral to the county. They're either no match or in-kind match, and we use pass-through money. So we only budget what we get.
What's your turnout rate?
Personnel. So it's, I wish I had my number, like the superintendent did. You know, we have 202 full-time permanent positions and about 12 to 14 vacancies. So that rate is not so great.
So you're just kind of floating, filling positions. But
right, that's correct. Yeah. And a lot of internal promotions is we have positions, so, you know, folks start at a lower level and move
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation.
Yes.
All right. Stacy for the health department.
That's right. I know you all are tired, so I'm going to try to be quick as well. So thank you for inviting us to come and present our budgets, and special thanks to my business officer, Janet Elliott, for her work that she does at the health department. So the health department has 3 budgets that you're aware of. The WIC budget, which is our Women's Infant Children's program, which is our supplemental nutrition program, our dental children's clinic budget, which serves children 0 to 21, and then our general health budget, which has our general public health operations and functions in it. So I'm going to start with the WIC budget and the dental budget because they're pretty small and there's not too much changing in those. What you see up there is the general health department budget. So for WIC, this is a federally funded program. And what you'll see here is that we actually have a reduction in your packet, a reduction of in that budget of about 1%. And so essentially, we get the federal funds. They tell us how much we're getting, and that's how much we budget for based on our personnel cost and our operating costs. So there's not much, there are no county tax dollars going into this, what you see in your packet. They are experiencing a 5% reduction in federal funds in that program. And then the second budget that I'll talk about is the dental clinic budget. And as you all are aware, this is our children's dental clinic that is self-sustaining. So what revenues they bring in are used to cover their operating expenses. And here you'll see that there's roughly a 7% decrease in their budget. And here we're adjusting, really the revenues are being adjusted to better align with their actual revenues that we've seen in the last few years. And that's a better reflection and it aligns with the actual money that they're bringing in. So that's why that looks a little different. There are no new resources requested in that budget either. Do you have any questions about WIC or dental before I move on to the big one? So the way that yes, partly. So the federal pass-through money. So whatever the federal government decides to do with their money, and if they decide to decrease that, then that comes down to the state, then comes down to local. And then their funding is also based on the caseload. So at this point, you're based on what percentage of caseload that you can
that you satisfy. So for our state requirements, that's about 97%, and we're hitting about 95% consistently. And that's across the state. We only have about, I think it's about a dozen counties that are meeting or exceeding caseload for WIC. And so I will just say on a side note, the Health Directors Association has taken that to our state partners in Division of Public Health to say, what's really going on here? If we only have a handful of those folks, those counties who are meeting caseload, is there something happening that we need to address that's bigger than just community outreach at a local level? Other questions about WIC or dental? Okay, so the health budget is our largest budget. And you'll see here, we're projecting roughly a 3% increase in our budget. And I would just will say to Commissioner Gailey's point earlier, we did project for personnel costs to increase, reflective of last year's trend with what we did with the pay and class study, just to give our Board of Health an idea of what that would look like. So you are seeing that reflected here in the personnel costs. So that is partly why you're seeing an increase in our request. And then major items that are being proposed, because you have the numbers in front of you, so I'm going to try to be quick. The major items that are being proposed are, we're asking for two positions, one being an environmental health position. And this position, we received $20,000 in grant funds that will help offset that position. And also, we're seeing increased revenues in environmental health that will also help to offset that position, the cost of that position. But we are seeing an increase in permits for food and lodging and on-site wastewater and wells. So we're starting to see that increase in building in our community, both homes and businesses, and also the increase in food and lodging establishments. And that usually is reflective in our needs for environmental health. The second position that you see is a patient accounts representative, which is essentially a reclass for us. And we're only asking for a half-time position for this. And this is really to have someone really focused on billing and coding, which is really important for medical practices. So in private practice, they have someone totally dedicated to billing and coding because it's important to get not only Medicaid dollars, but your private insurance dollars and your debt collection dollars back. We don't have a dedicated person for that. And so this is our request to have someone who's dedicated so that we can really get the most potential revenue back to us to help with our operating costs. And then we have a few capital outlay requests. We have the bariatric beds, which we requested last year, and we had that cut. Those beds, we're starting to see more and more overweight and obese patients in our clinics, and our beds currently are fairly old. And for safety reasons, we have asked for an expenditure of $13,000 to purchase beds that are more designed for the population that we are seeing and more safe. We also have the next two capital outlay expenditures that you see kind of go hand in hand. This is for us to upgrade the worn out locks that are in HSC. And the non-functioning security cameras as a safety function. There's some opportunity between Health Department and DSS to look at where those costs overlay each other and have some cost savings there. The fourth request is for a used vehicle. I'm sure you guys have heard me say on numerous occasions that we have a very aging fleet of the 26 vehicles we have, about 17 of them are greater than or equal to 10 years old or older. And so we are asking in this proposed budget to purchase another used vehicle to replace our aging fleet. The other operating expenses that you see there are not necessarily new requests, but they're things that might have gotten your attention as you were looking at our budget. And one is for our medical director. We have switched from a county-funded position to a contracted position with the hospital. So that looks like a new expense to you, but that's actually an old expense that was sort of in the salary line item and has sort of been pulled out. We're actually saving about a little over $21,000 doing that by contract versus having a county-funded position. You'll also see there that we had an increase in vehicle repairs and maintenance line item, and again, that goes back to that aging fleet. We still do have 17 vehicles in our fleet that are over 10 years old, and some of them over 15, and that requires a bit more maintenance and repair. And then there was a slight increase in our training line item, and some of that has to do with the emerging communicable disease and public health training that is required of our staff and our contracted workforce, but also due to, as we have folks who are retiring, raising up that new generation of our public health workforce and making sure they're trained adequately. And that's our budget. Do you have questions?
How many beds do you get?
13,000.
I believe that's two. Yeah, that's wow. Just two. Medical equipment is pretty expensive. Yeah.
The hospital's had to deal with that same issue.
Yeah, lots of medical practices are having to modify and supplement our medical equipment to meet the needs of our population as it changes.
Thank you, Stacy. No more
other questions?
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right. Brian, you're up to bat.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I have a presentation to go through with you that will be an overview of county government's budget for next fiscal year. This is taking the place of what we normally do, where each department comes before you, gives information about their requests. So I'm going to touch on some of the highlights of the department's request, personnel and equipment and things like that. And I'm going to try to go quickly because I know it is getting late. But at any time that you have any questions, please stop me, and I'll be happy to try to answer it. We also have department heads here, as I'm sure you've seen them around tonight. They can answer any more detailed questions that you might have. We also, in your books, I think it's important to point out that we have these new summaries, these new snapshots of departments. We put those in there hoping that that'll help you decipher a little bit easier what departments are up to. And I know the sheriff and DSS and health have already gone through theirs, but that's been a very good tool so far. So I'll go through this right away, and if as I go, if you have any questions, please stop me. So you've heard a lot of talk tonight about our new strategic plan, and we've worked very hard with the departments as we put this budget information together to try to keep that in front of departments as they start making decisions about what kind of activities to fund. And there you can see our five pillars. Also in your department summaries, there's information about what the departments are requesting, but we also have a page for each department that lists their performance management goals for 17-18 fiscal year. And we asked each department to think about the strategic plan while they're formulating their goals, and there are some little icons beside each goal. You can trace them back to see what pillar they match to. But we'll be posting all these once the budget's approved. We'll put all this information on the website where the public will be able to view it. So let's get right into the numbers myself. What you have tonight in this book is a preliminary general fund budget. Okay, this is preliminary. It's departmental requests, outside agency requests. The total at this time is $155,197,791. That does not include a couple of larger possible projects that I'm going to touch on as I get deeper into our presentation. But you can see the county government accounts for a little over $100 million of that figure. Education for about $52 million, a little over $52 million of that figure. And our outside agencies, which I'm going to talk again about just a little bit, is a little over $3 million. You see a chart here that kind of lays out the nature of these expenses. You can see that education is about a third of our proposed spending so far. It's the largest piece of our county dollar pie. We do have human services and public safety are the other two large areas where we spend our money. So I'm going to touch on a little bit about departmental personnel requests. So from all the departments across county government, this is county government only, we have a request for a total of 28 new positions. I'm going to go through some brief details about each one of these, but if you have any questions, you can certainly ask. We are proposing two new career ladders, one in the county manager and legal department. These are for our clerk and deputy clerk, and also for our fire marshal's office, so the fire marshal, the fire inspectors can kind of get on par with building inspections and be able to get a career ladder for when they move up in their certifications. We also have two position reclasses. One is our planner one moving to a planner two, and the other is the new part-time position that's a reclass from an old position that Stacy just talked about in the health department, the patient account rep four. So a little bit of brief details about each one of these position requests, because this is some of our most important, this is our most important resources, our folks. So we are asking for a human resource analyst in the human resources department. And I'll tell you that I requested that HR put this position in. The reason I did is because we are very interested in trying to do a little bit more about training our employees, particularly getting folks ready for supervisory positions. And we also are interested in doing more in-house analysis of turnover, retention, how we recruit people, those kind of things. So we also have requests here from the tax department for two new positions. Both will be involved with generating additional revenue. In fact, the delinquent tax collector, we believe, will generate a significant amount of revenue, more than it will cost us to do that position. Then in MIS, we're requesting a new emergency service tech specialist. We already have one, and this would allow us to have 24 hours a day, 7 days a week coverage. This is targeting our emergency services, which, as you know, they are on the go 24 hours a day. And for them, technology is becoming even more important. Each car or ambulance all have computers and all kinds of equipment in them. So this would be a very helpful for, position for our IT department. Health, Stacy just talked about the request for the environmental health specialist. I'll tell you, I receive complaints on occasion about the amount of time it takes for food service plans to be reviewed. That's from people trying to do a new restaurant or change their restaurant because of the amount of work they have. I think we're at 3 weeks right now for delay, so this would be very helpful in reducing that wait. And then we have the information here about the social services employees that Kelly and Susan mentioned. Four of those folks are already in their budget. But Susan and DSS are asking, they were originally funded for a limited period of time, I believe it was 2 years, so this would be the year that we would fund them regularly. So the money is already in DSS's budget, but we would make them permanent regular employees, and they do need them. We have a request from the Cooperative Extension Service to fund a position that has been vacant for some time. This is a family and consumer science agent. This position would be funded 83% by the county, 17% by the state. One of the important functions of this position, they conduct our Serve Safe food program that trains restaurant workers on how to safely handle food. In the public safety sector of county government, we're asking for a position in the fire marshal's office. You remember last year we split emergency management from the fire marshal, and we took one position from the fire marshal to do that. Well, due to the growth in Alamance County and the building and the number of plans that they have to review, that, taking that position has put them behind significantly, so we're suggesting that we put a fire inspector position back in the fire marshal's office. And then in EMS, we're asking for four paramedics, and I'm going to talk a little bit about EMS as I go through equipment and into fees, but EMS is suggesting that we add four paramedics. This would allow for the department to staff a 12-hour peak time truck. We have 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. is the busy time of day for EMS, and that is when we run out of trucks, and we believe if we added another crew and another truck, we would cut down on the number of times that we are out of units. Then the library is asking for one full-time position, a person that would specialize in technology and be able to help patrons that are coming in to use computers and have all kinds of questions about their own technological devices that they bring with them, as well as four part-time positions. These are 25 hours a week. You can see they are in children's services, reference services, North Park and outreach services, as well as technical, which is book repair and cataloging books. And then we also have requests for two positions from the Parks Department. Northern Park Manager, this person would oversee all the operations in the northern part of Alamance County, all the park properties, as well as a new Park Technician 1. This is due to the increased visitation that we have at our parks. Parks Department feels like they would benefit from having a new park tech. That was flying through personnel, but I'm gonna continue to go on, and since there are no questions. We have just a general overview of the equipment requests from the departments. For general equipment, we have $466,000. Largest request is from EMS for over $300,000. This is for the second year of the leases of the new heart monitors. Last year, we leased new heart monitors, replaced ones that were, I think, 10 or 15 years old. They were quite outdated. So this $317,000 includes the next year's payment for those heart monitors. It also, we're looking at leasing equipment, mostly to just avoid that big upfront capital cost. Lucas II are compression units that do CPR on people, victims that need CPR, as well as 9 power stretchers. Those power stretchers would outfit the rest of EMS's ambulance. We have a couple in place now. They lift patients that are very, very large, and they're also able to automatically put them in the back of the vehicle. It saves us a tremendous amount of money on workers' comp and injuries to our employees. Computer equipment, we're looking at $277,000. The majority of that is for our IT department for the technology plan, which I'll briefly touch on in just a moment. It's also for fire suppression that we would put in our new server room over at HSC, as well as to do some updates to the commissioner's meeting room that would include cameras and some monitors, some updating of the equipment at county office building. One thing I do want to mention here that's actually in the Board of Elections budget, it's not out in a capital code, most of this is capital, but is $1.4 million that we're proposing that we need to give some consideration to buy new voting equipment. You know, the state is making all kinds of changes to the types of voting equipment that we would be needing to have in fiscal year 18-19. So this is the estimated cost to go to what we believe the state will require. We really need to this year consider some level of funding, setting something aside to be prepared for fiscal year 18-19. Kathy has let me know that there is a House bill in place right now that's being considered that would allocate, I believe it was $50 million for the state to help us with that, and it would be a match of up to $500,000. So we certainly hope that that will go through, and if we have some money in place, we would be able to try to apply for a match to offset the cost of this new voting equipment. Overview of the vehicles that the departments are requesting. The total dollar amount of requests for new vehicles is $879,137. That includes vehicle for maintenance, the vehicles the sheriff discussed at $350,000. A new vehicle for the fire marshal, this would be for the new employee, the new fire inspector. Our inspections department is requesting 3 Kia Souls. They have one of those now. Those are quite cheap, gas efficient vehicles, and they have a aged fleet that they would use those new vehicles to replace ones. EMS is asking for one replacement ambulance. That would be for the new peak truck, as well as 2 remounts and a new medic unit, a quick response vehicle. That's $340,000. Health, as Stacy mentioned, the used Honda Civic, and then recreation is asking for 2 vehicles, a new truck and a new 15-passenger van. Just to touch on some other capital items and improvements from across county government, the library is asking for $286,000 to purchase new books, new audiovisual materials, and electronic materials. And then we have other improvements for a little over $200,000. The majority of this is for our maintenance department. We have a capital improvement plan, and that plan is for projects that are over $10,000. We also have in the maintenance department's budget we've included these funds to try to do repair work for projects under $10,000. There are a total of 20 of them. As you can see, we broke it down, 5 are HVAC, 5 are to install some rooftop safety implements, and 2 are involving fire safety. And then we have the Recreation and Parks Department asking for $77,000 to do the repairs that are listed, including some new disc golf tee pads, repairs at Eli Whitney, and the restoration of the Garrett log cabin out at Cedar Rock Park. I just mentioned the capital improvement plan. We're on year 3 of 5. We're suggesting this year that we consider a $500,000 allocation. This fiscal year 16-17, our allocation was $250,000. And we've done that for 2 years now, and it has really pushed our capital. We have a great deal of deferred capital. It's several million dollars money that projects that we probably will never actually get to at a $250,000 level. So we're suggesting that we'd like to consider a $500,000. You can see that I won't go through every single one of these projects, but in general, we have about $124,000 worth of roofing needs, $167,000 worth of boiler and chiller needs. Paving needs to the tune of about $42,000, $50,000 worth of plumbing needs, and then we have some overhead doors that need to be replaced at the maintenance department, $16,000. We in this half a million dollars also includes the $58,800 that we believe we would need for some of these projects would need to be engineered so we can get bids that are apples to apples, and we're also including $42,200 as contingency for those projects. Then just to touch on our landfill, it's an enterprise fund, so it's not in the general fund, which is most of what I'm talking about here, but wanted to let you know that the landfill has some equipment needs to the tune of $1.4 million. You can see they're looking at backhoes and trucks and some other things. The majority of that money is going to be spent, though, on the new access road and double scales. That is about $1,250,000. They're in the process of putting that in now. They started the timber. Timbering has begun at the landfill. The idea behind the access road and the double scales is to make it a little safer for the large trucks, the big waste haulers, to get in and out. They would not use the same entrance as, you know, I use when I go to the landfill. Also, with the double scales, we would be able to weigh trucks when they come in with their waste and then when they go out. So we will get a very accurate reading. Landfill staff believes that that will generate some significant revenue for us. So. The technology improvement plan I touched on a moment ago, this is in our IT budget, $171,000. It includes doing some work to virtualize some more of our servers and to try to make our software more web-based, where we may be able to, as we invest in hardware, PCs, we don't have to buy such expensive computers because we're using web-based software. We can get a little bit less expensive computers. Also, the bring your own device management. We have folks that are using their cell phones, tablets much more today. We're concerned about security. We were able to spend, if we spend some of this money, we believe we'll be able to make all these devices more secure by alienating the county part of folks' phones. Also, this tech plan has east-west internal security. We've done a lot of work recently on keeping people out, right? Security that keeps out the bad guys. But if they get in, we want to do a little bit more work on what they can do if they do get into our system. So. Fee changes. We are looking at fee changes in several departments, fire marshal, inspections, and parks. I think Robert Key handed you some information about inspections. They are looking at some fee changes. One thing Robert and his group are looking to do is waive some fees if people are putting in residential sprinklers, which is a great idea to encourage folks to think about that when they're building a home. It's not terribly expensive to put them in. It can save your property in the event of a fire, save your life. Also, we have some fee increases for parks, but I really want to talk to you just briefly about EMS's proposed fee. You've heard me say already a lot about EMS, employees, vehicles, new peak truck. We're suggesting that we consider raising EMS's fees to help pay for these enhancements to the service. We would be going to 130% of the Medicare allowable fee. We are not at that now, which is kind of industry standard. We are below industry standard currently. If we make this change and implement these fees that you, these fee changes that you see here, it's going to generate about $300,000 more a year from our current level of service. That will significantly help offset the cost of these new employees and the peak time truck. And it will not have an effect on our Medicare or Medicaid riders. And most private insurances pay to this level of Medicare allowable. So we think that we would be bringing ourselves up to industry standard. We would see a significant amount of revenue increase, and that will help us offset the cost of these additions to EMS service. So here are some items I just want to make sure is on your radar as they are on mine. You know, I told you the county government's about $100 million total out of that $155 million. There are a few things that I want to make sure that you're aware of because we're thinking about them. They're not in the $155 million. They're not there yet. We're trying to figure out how they might be able to be worked in. One is the replacement of our emergency response radios. Back in 2009 and 10, we did a mass buy-up of the 800 megahertz radios. I think we did most of that through installment loan. Well, they are reaching a point in their life where they have been well used and are, we're going to be reaching a point where we'll have difficulty getting parts and getting replacements for those radios. There are a total of 505. For us to purchase all that we need at one time, we're looking at about $2.6 million. We're also looking at leasing those. That would be a 7-year lease. And this is a very preliminary figure for lease, but we think it would be around $395,000 a year. That would be if we replace all 500 radios at one time. So that's an item that is not in this dollar figure yet, but we are giving consideration to. Also for our employee health insurance, we are self-funded health insurance plan. We have had difficulty meeting the amount of claims. We have no fund balance at this time. We have had difficulty in the past making paying out all of our claims. So we're in year two of a corrective action, and this year we are considering a $2.6 million increase that would be needed just for our employees to make sure that we continue to be able to pay their claims. And what we would like to be able to do is have some fund balance in place, some savings account. So that's another pretty large item that's not in this mix yet, but we are giving attention to. Also, the $155 million, all these department budgets that you've seen so far that include their personnel costs, none of those personnel costs or that $155 million includes any kind of cost of living raise. I want to put that out there, that a 1% cost of living raise for county employees would be $490,000. So every percent of a possible cost of living is $490,000. And then we have a salary pay plan, as you're well aware. We did a study several years ago, and we've been working, trying to implement that plan. A full step on that plan is $1.4 million. And that affects folks that are below midpoint. So, you know, this year, 16-17, we did a 1.5% cost of living, and we did a 1.5% step for everybody below midpoint. So we've worked all kinds of different variations on cost of livings or steps, but I wanted to be sure you knew we're looking at these dollar amounts too when it comes to employee pay. Give you a little bit of information here about debt service. Our total outstanding principal is over $57 million. That's how much debt we currently have. You can see how it breaks down. For the county, we have $4.7 million. That is not bonds, those are installments. For ABSS, you can see we have currently $25.8 million in bonds and $4.6 million in installments. And then for the community college, we have $22.2 million in bond debt. Our payment that we are looking to budget for debt service next fiscal year is $9.5 million. That's how much we will have to budget next year for debt payment. You can see it's broke down there. Of that $9 million, $1.9 for the county, $5.6 for ABSS, and $2 million for Alamance Community College. Just thought you'd be interested to know, because I know there's been a lot of talk about bonds and other debt that we may consider. Our legal debt margin is $998 million, and that is based on 8% of our valuation. So you've already heard about Alamance-Burnham School System. I did put this in the slide just to let you know that there's their increase in what they're asking for in current expense and capital outlay. And Alamance Community College also, their current expense request, their capital outlay request, and the total increase from this fiscal year. Outside agency requests, our total amount is a little over $3 million. There are 20 outside agencies that we fund. Four of those agencies receive county funds just as grant matches. So that's the $382,000. Five of these agencies are funded by occupancy tax. And the occupancy tax this year we have projected at $777,000. Then we break, two-thirds of that money has to go to the TDA. So it automatically, by law, goes to the TDA. The other third we send to, we fund the Historic Museum, the Arts Association, sort of piece, and we do fund a small portion of the Parks Department for the programs that they put on, our Parks Department, County Recreation, for the programs and activities and facilities that they have that draw tourists in. We have 11 other outside agencies. All these folks will be coming to you on May 1st, 9 a.m., County Commissioner's Room. You'll be able to see them all. They'll talk to you. I did want you to know that this year we have two brand new requests from two groups that we have never funded before. One is Allied Churches in the dollar amount of $100,000. And we have a request also from Young Musicians of Alamance for $5,000. So these folks will be coming to you on May 1 to talk to you about all their requests too. So we've very quickly gone through spending and personnel and equipment and all the very high flyover of county government, county departments. I wanted to give you a little bit of information about the revaluation. You can see here that what we're trying to show you here is how our base has grown since 2009. The 2009 valuation, we were at $12.5 billion. And this current valuation, the one that is just being completed, we're at $13.5 billion. That's a percent change of 9.3%, showing that we have grown over the past 8 years. So the tax base valuation in 2016, this year, is $317 million. The tax base that we are looking at for the upcoming 17-18 fiscal year is $13.5 billion. That change between this fiscal year and next fiscal year is 1.6%. So you can take a look in your books if you'd like, and you can look at the revenue neutral computation worksheet. It's on page 597. You can see that the assessed value is the number I just quoted to you, $13,532,708,003. The worksheet calculates out an average growth over the years before since our last evaluation of 1.45%. The worksheet is telling us right now is that our estimated revenue neutral tax rate is 57.9 cents. And I want to stress that this is preliminary, that we are going to wait till the end of April. April is a big appeal month. Things are going very well right now. I can't say enough about the job that Jeremy and his staff have done. I know you all have heard that. You hear it out in the community too. I understand the appeals are going very well right now, but we want to make sure we get through the month of April, and then we will know if appeals gone well, and that will have an effect on this revenue neutral tax rate. But right now, based on what we have seen and the sheet that we have filled out, that is our revenue neutral tax rate. If you figure that we're going to have a collection rate, we're going to use a collection rate of 98.64% to project the dollars that that would equate out to, and that is our 15-16 collection rate. And also a motor vehicle collection rate of 99.99%. Now that the state is collecting that, the collection rate is quite high. We would estimate, based on this preliminary revenue neutral tax rate, that we will bring in a little more than $77 million in property tax revenue. And all this would mean that 1 cent equals $1.3 million. So revenue sources for this upcoming budget, the really large revenue sources that we can do many different things with, because we have revenue sources, of course, that are restricted and are state and federal monies that are tied to specific programs. But the large revenue sources that we have flexibility, of course, is property tax. Based on that information we just went over, revenue neutral, that's a little preliminary, we believe we will have about $3.7 million in additional property tax funds. If we go with revenue neutral and it stays the same based on the appeals, we'll be looking at about $3.7 million in additional property tax funding still coming in. I put that up there again. It's still fluid until May. When I come back to you with the manager's recommended budget, all this will be locked in. We will tell you the revenue neutral rate. We'll have all these projections much, much closer, but this is pretty close. Sales tax in this budget information, this preliminary budget that we have given you, we have included a $1.2 million increase in sales tax. That may go up. We'd like to have 10 full months under our belt, which again, May 1 will be in a really good place to be able to speak a little bit more about can we project additional sales tax revenue. We certainly hope that we can, but that gives you an idea of right now we're looking at about $1.2 million in additional sales tax revenue. And when you look at this information that we've given you so far, we are not showing any fund balance use. The difference, on my last slides, I think, is the difference between requests and revenue. We're not showing any fund balance at this time, except there's about $250,000 in the information that you have that is a home care community block grant that is pass-through money. So. But when we talk about fund balance, it's important to think about it. Our unassigned fund balance is at $31.2 million right now. That is at 22.7% of our expenditures. That's very good. The board has a target of 25%. We're not quite there yet, but we have a much healthier fund balance than we have in the past. And this graph that you see gives you an idea of the amount of fund balance that has been budgeted over the past 5 years and the amount that we have either put back in fund balance or spent. And you can see that we have budgeted this fiscal year, we budgeted $5.7 million in fund balance to balance the budget. So far each year on this graph, we have added to fund balance every year. So I would tell you that you can expect that we will be budgeting fund balance to balance the budget. That will be something you can look to see in the manager's recommended budget. We will want to be careful how much that we balance. We want to be sure that if we are going to be looking at future bonds, we want to be sure we keep a good savings account and we keep a good bond rating up. Ours has just recently improved. So the difference, this is my different slide, the difference between requests and estimated revenue, the requests are over $155 million. That's county government, ABSS, ACC, the whole works. The revenues, based on no fund balance, preliminary revenue neutral, slight increase to sales tax, $138 million. The difference between the two, between the requests and the money that we are seeing right now is $16.4 million. And if we were going to try to cover that gap, that difference with property tax increase, that would equate to a 12.13-cent property tax increase to make that difference up. I think we had estimated around between 9 and 10 cents for ABSS if the bond was between 135 and 150 million, and then ACC we're looking at 2.6 to 2.7 cents if they with a $39 million.
Go back to your, if you don't mind, go back to the bond indebtedness for our county. Because we jumped through this, and I don't think most people understand the legal debt margin. Theoretically, we could owe $1 billion.
Yes.
And we owe what, 40?
57.6 All right. million.
So the difference is that the jail, the 48.
No, that's the total amount owed in bonds, that 48.2. So the only bond debt that we owe is ABSS and Alamance Community College.
So we don't owe nothing on the jail, bond-wise?
No, sir.
We
okay.
do owe on the jail slightly over $1 million, but that was done through an installment loan and not a bond.
That's all we owe on the jail, $1 million. All right.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to say this in any light of anybody taking this that we can afford more debt. But doggone it, the county needs to get some credit for the pay-as-you-go attitude that I think this county's had last 2 years and prior. Bob brought up a good report. You mentioned the treasurer's report. Remember that? You sent that out to everybody. If you look at that report, there's about we're in a population bracket. I'm not sure. 199,000 people down, if I'm not mistaken. Everybody above us are the mega counties. You know, Mecklenburg, Wake, I think Cumberland, I'm not sure. But we're in that big group of about 24 counties below the mega groups, mega counties. Of the 24, And that report that you passed out, and I'd been looking at that report before I left the board 2 years ago, there were only two below us that had a lower per capita bond indebtedness for their citizens. There was like 23 from 24, there was 21 had worse bond indebtedness per capita. And doggone it, that's something we ought to, you know, be proud of. That doesn't mean we can go borrow more money or that we should, but you take our bond indebtedness, Guilford County is only three times our size, our school system's three times our size. They have a bond indebtedness of $1 billion, last time I heard, or close to it, $1 billion. Look at that. I'm proud of that. Bob ought to be proud of it.
I'm not sure if I understand what, I remember sending out a report of where we stood on
our property tax. Right. But did I?
Where you send it out from the treasurer, the state treasurer.
Oh.
We had a several columns of how we stood and what everybody's tax rates were.
So we'll go back and look at that.
Yeah, you said it. Yeah, I remember seeing it. And because I thought the innuendo was that from you was that we could afford to go into debt more and or possibly we could afford to raise taxes more. That's the way I took it when I saw a copy of it. But anyway, bottom line is, that's something to be proud of. Most people think, well, you know, you shouldn't owe that. Well, the price of that is not even the cost of one school, you know. I don't think most people understand how conservative this county has been and the benefits we've paid.
If you have specific questions that you want to address to any departments, now is the time.
I'm going to ask one more, and I'm ready to go when everybody else is, but bottom line is our revenue at the end of this fiscal year, I know what we got, one more quarter?
Yes.
Well, even if you got a year to date through the end of the third quarter?
Yes.
Or an estimate for the end of the fiscal year, how much more revenue are we going to have in all categories versus last year, last end of last fiscal year?
Susan, can you help me address that?
I can. I'm still in the process of getting things together for the budget retreat. I have not run that analysis as of yet, but I can do that and have that to the board tomorrow.
And you got any feeling about it at all?
I would hate to comment off the top of my head without running the analysis.
And the reason I'm asking that is the even the United States has got record revenues coming in. And I would assume that it filters down to the state level and local level, county level.
So we have seen an uptick the past 3 years in our sales tax revenue significantly, as it seems the economy has come back and more people are shopping here and buying things. And that's one of our revenue figures that we're going to look at before we come to managers recommended. Because if we get that 10th month in and we feel comfortable about increasing the 1.2 to something higher, we will certainly do that. We try to remain conservative, of course, but we see that growth also.
I got to tell you one about talking about those three counties where there were three or two that had a better per capita than us. One of them was is Wayne or somebody. I'm not sure who it was, but they had no bonded debt, none, hardly none. And I called the county manager. This was 2 years ago. And I said, how have you managed this? He said, we got $100 million in the fund balance. And I started looking at their tax rate. And their tax rate was almost 80 cents per 100. And it was a county manager just talking to a commissioner. I said, well, just you and I talking. I said, what you got is a tax rate that's much higher than it probably needs to be in that county to facilitate no bond indebtedness and or have such a huge fund balance. You know what he said? He laughed. He said, well, don't come down here and tell everybody. But I wouldn't be very proud of why his records are as good as they are. His tax rate was much higher than it needed to be to run that county. I
Well, I think if you heard, you have heard tonight that the departments have done a pretty good job trying to hold the line on their budgets or find innovative ways to come up with revenue that's not general fund. We certainly appreciate that. And they've also done an excellent job proposing goals for next year. That's the other side of it. The money is one side, but that service is the other. And we think the way that they manage themselves through the performance management program has been very effective and helps ensure that citizens get good quality service when they pay for it. Is there any other questions for me or anyone else from the department's side of the house?
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you all
for your concise report there. And I'm sure we'll have more discussions.
Yes.
Commissioners, any comments? Well, with no comments, I will say we're adjourned.